का जो एचआर फोरम था इट वॉज वेरी वाइब्रेंट एट वन पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम एंड इट वॉज सो वाइब्रेंट दैट वी वर एबल टू डू सम इंडो पाक एचआर समिट्स एज वेल. सो 2004 में वी डिड अ समिट इन न्यू दिल्ली और वहाँ पे हम कोई 50 के करीब कॉर्पोरेट डेलीगेट्स लेके गए थे पाकिस्तान से. 2005 में वी होस्टेड अगेन इंडियंस इन पाकिस्तान और सरीना इस्लामाबाद में सेकेंड इंडो पाक एचआर समिट किया था हमने. एंड दैट वॉज अ टाइम जब पाकिस्तान इंडिया की दोस्ती हुई हुई थी काफ़ी हद तक एंड वी वर एबल टू होस्ट 150 इंडियंस विद देयर स्पाउसेस इन इस्लामाबाद एंड वी हैड अराउंड 700 पाकिस्तानी डेलीगेट्स. सो उस स्पिरिट में फिर ये फॉरम चलता रहा एंड देन आई डिसाइडेड कि हम ऐसा फॉरम लॉन्च करें जो तीनों शहरों में हो बिकॉज वो इस्लामाबाद फॉरम इस्लामाबाद में एग्जिस्ट करता था, लाहौर फॉरम लाहौर में करता था एंड दे वर डूइंग वेरी वेल. बट देन आई थॉट वी शुड कम अप विद अ नेशनल बॉडी जो कि सिर्फ प्रोफेशनल्स रन करें और प्रोफेशनल्स ही उसको आगे लेके जाएं. सो बेसिकली व्हेन आई से प्रोफेशनल आई मेंट के वी स्टार्टेड विद द एचआर प्रोफेशनल्स बट देन वी कॉल्ड इट पाकिस्तान ह्यूमन कैपिटल फॉरम. व्हाई? बिकॉज पाकिस्तान ह्यूमन कैपिटल रिलेट्स टू ऑल द फंक्शंस. सो इट्स नॉट ओनली एचआर, इट्स ह्यूमन कैपिटल. सो ऑल ऑफ अस आर ह्यूमन कैपिटल, राइट? वेदर इट इज एकेडेमिया, वेदर इट इज इंडस्ट्री, मेन स्ट्रीम कॉर्पोरेट और इंटरनेशनल, जहाँ भी आप जाते हैं. सो पूरी दुनिया में बात ही हो रही होती है कि चाइना अपने ह्यूमन कैपिटल को कैसे लेवरेज कर रहा है, इंडिया कैसे कर रहा है, यूएस कैसे कर रहा है, रशिया कैसे कर रहा है. सो आई थॉट कि पाकिस्तान का जो ह्यूमन कैपिटल है उसको शोकेस करने की ज़रूरत है, पहले तो पाकिस्तान में, यू नो, सो दैट द इंडस्ट्री गिव अस द रिस्पेक्ट दैट वी एक्चुअली कमांड एंड देन ऑल्सो वी टेक इट अब्रॉड. सो पाकिस्तान ह्यूमन कैपिटल फॉरम नाम हमने इसलिए रखा था. अच्छा, जब वो बन गया तो उसके बाद वी थॉट कि अब हम इसको चलाएंगे कैसे, बिकॉज इंडिविजुअली बहुत सारे फॉरम्स इस चीज़ का शिकार हो जाते हैं कि दे आर एसोसिएटेड विद फ्यू नेम्स ओनली. सो व्हाट आई डिड वाज आई स्टार्टेड विद दिस कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ कोर टीम्स. अच्छा, कोर टीम का कॉन्सेप्ट ये है कि एक नेट ऑफ इंडिविजुअल्स जो कि विच कुड कंप्राइज ऑफ मैक्सिमम 10 to 15 पीपल एक स्पेसिफिक ड्यूरेशन के लिए फॉरम को चलाए और इस तरह चलाए कि वो सारे वॉलंटियर बेस में हो बिकॉज फॉरम इज़ अ नॉन प्रॉफिट ऑर्गेनाइजेशन. So we didn't want to keep it commercial because obviously जब commercial आता है तो there are so many ifs and buts involved. So we thought कि एक volunteer body को चलाने के लिए एक set of volunteers को लेते हैं और हर शहर में लेते हैं because ownership आती है, local teams की ownership आती है. So we came up with this concept के दो साल के लिए core team बनाते हैं और एक core team का एक chapter lead होगा और उस chapter lead के अंदर 5-6 heads होंगे और वो जो heads हैं वो अपने respective duties perform करेंगे with the help of 1 or 2 assistants and that is how we include people from various industries and capacities to make it run as a team. So humne ye experiment 4 dafa kar liya hai Islamabad mein aur 4 dafa Lahore mein bhi kar liya. So every 2 years I change the team. Why I change the team? Because I want new people to come in aur wo jo hum kehte hain na inclusiveness and diversity in its true sense. Assalamu alaikum, kaise hain aap? It's good to see you here. So 2 saal bahut arsa hota hai ek team ke liye perform karne ke liye but diversity usme badi important hai. So I would rather keep 7-8 people but they'll be from 7-8 industries and then they'll be heading some responsibilities which are in addition to their jobs. So koi bhi naukri chhod ke nahi aa raha forum. That was the concept and we ran it successfully because Lahore mein I have changed 4 times the core teams aur isme hum kya karte hain ki 25% old team ko include karte hain taki continuity rahe lekin 75% naye log le aate hain. अच्छा, वो जो नए लोग हैं वो भी ओन करते हैं फॉरम को बट पुराने जो लोग हैं दे स्टे इन द फॉरम बिकॉज एवरीबडी इज स्टिल अ मेंबर फॉर देयर रिमेनिंग पीरियड. जितना अरसा वो अपनी मेंबरशिप को रिन्यू कराना चाहते हैं और जो ओल्ड टीम है ऑब्वियसली इज ऑल्सो रिकग्नाइज बिकॉज ऑब्वियसली दे आर द वंस हु हैव गिवन देयर टाइम टू द फॉरम. सो इस्लामाबाद में भी हम 4 चैप्टर लीड्स चेंज कर चुके हैं, लाहौर में भी हम 8 साल हो गए हैं 4 चैप्टर लीड्स चेंज कर चुके हैं. देन वी डिसाइडेड कि अब हमने इसको कराची तो लाना ही है बट वी ऑल्सो टेक इट बियॉन्ड पाकिस्तान. सो लास्ट ईयर वी स्टार्टेड एक्सपेंडिंग, वी मेड अ कोर टीम इन मीना रीजन विच इज़ उसका न्यूक्लियस हमने दुबई रखा बिकॉज ऑब्वियसली मीना का जो सबसे सेंट्रल हब है फॉर ऑल कोऑर्डिनेशन इज दुबई. आई हैव पर्सनली वर्कड इन मीना रीजन, आई वॉज हेड ऑफ पास पीपल एडवाइजरी फॉर अंस एंड यंग इन बहरेन. सो मेरे पास ये 12 मुल्क थे. सो आई सॉ वेरी क्लियरली कि जो भी सेंटर ऑफ एक्टिविटीज़ है वो सबको दुबई ज़्यादा सूट करता है. सो वी स्टार्टेड विद दुबई. नाउ दुबई हैज़ अ कोर टीम जिस तरह हमने यहाँ पर बनाई हुई है उसी तरह दुबई में भी हम क्वार्टरली सेशन अब रन कर रहे हैं. सो इट इज़ कॉल्ड PHCF मीना रीजन. That was the start of our international expansion. Very recently, I went to the United States and we've started doing PHCF North America. Now, North America se murad ye ke uske do coast humne develop kar liye. East Coast ki team launch ki hai bhi aur wo apne sessions karegi kyunki East Coast bahut bada hai. You know, as you all understand, America, and when I say North America, I mean US and Canada, has a huge East Coast. It's like 3,500 kilometer. Now, uske andar Florida se leke all the way to New Jersey, New York, and then you can even go further down. And then, aap Canada ki side bhi dekhen, to pura jo belt hai, which is, you know, Toronto and all the side, uske andar humne Pakistanis ko identify kiya, humne kaha yahan pe ek team banate hain, jo, with specific reference to North America, apne human capital challenges ko discuss kare. Or it is not Pakistani-centric only. Wo DNA Pakistani hai to run it. But that doesn't mean that non-Pakistanis cannot be members. They are also members, and they would obviously be speakers from any nationality who would like to be a speaker. So we have North America mein bhi settled kar liya, and I went there, we started with the first session. And now we are going to West Coast. Mein leke ja rahe hain. So we are going to open PHCF West Coast. Now West Coast would be starting from the Bay Area, California, and San Francisco se hum isko start kar rahe hain. You'll be very happy to note that there are 95,000 Pakistanis, expats, who are working in California. So these numbers are very big. You know, obviously, this is a Pakistani diaspora, which is in the whole world. So we have planned that wherever there is a Pakistani diaspora, we will take this forum. And in the world, there are 13 centers of excellence when it comes to Pakistani community, you know, which are regions, where Pakistanis are more. So we have identified those 13 areas, such as US, such as UK, such as Germany, such as Australia, Canada, and we'll go there, inshallah. So our plan is that in the next 1.5 years, we will launch in 13 countries PHCF. Ko. And why I'm doing it, the vision is that in the whole world, there are 1 million white-collar Pakistani. Hai. So in total, there are 9 million Pakistanis in the world. The overseas Pakistani ministry ka data hai, uske hisab se, minimum 9 million Pakistanis are outside Pakistan. Unme se 6 million dependents and 3 million are working. So those 3 million who are working, unme se 1 million are white collar. Now that this number could vary, but this is what I got. Mera ye vision tha, aur humne apni advisory council se baat ki, to we thought ki hum white collar ke upar pehle concentrate karein, because obviously hum sab ki zyada jo expertise hai, we are all white collar, right? And then these Pakistani experts are doing wonders in the world. And they are also sending a lot of remittances to the country. So they have a national strategic importance as far as the finances of this country are concerned. So humne socha ki white collar se shuru karte hain, and then white collar jahan jahan hai usse connect karte hain. So ye jo 1 million hai usme majority in 13 mulkon mein jahan isko leke ja rahe hain forum ko. Now obviously it looks like a tall order ki bhi 13 mulkon mein kaise karenge aur chalayenge kaise, at the same time in 13 mulkon ko aapas mein connect kaise karenge. So what we thought ki jab Pakistani bahar jata hai to uske expatriation ke bhi challenges hote hain na, because hum sab like agar aap mein se koi decide kare aaj ki maine Karachi se uthke Sydney jana hai Australia, ya maine Canada jana hai, you know, Vancouver jana hai. So there is no system, support system that is available from corporate to corporate. Obviously embassies are there, wo apna kaam kar rahi hain. Corporate to corporate support available nahi hai. So I thought ki ek aisi community agar exist kare jo ek dusre se connect kar sake online and offline. So you can imagine the returns, you know. For example, when you land over there, the first help you need is to seek a job, right? Now you would go to the, you know, job centers and headhunters in those countries, which are obviously not Pakistanis. So they'll take their time to help you. And with all respect to their expertise, wo first connect build hone mein time lagta. So what I have, you know, taken on myself as a founder of this forum and requested all my friends to do is to help, start helping Pakistanis wherever we are connected. In one, getting a job, but not only getting a job, in getting oriented to that country as a culture. Because hota kya hai ki hum jaate hain to obviously kuch rishtedar hame milte hain, kuch friends milte hain, lekin wo jo aapko view de rahe hote hain wo limited view hota hai, because obviously that is limited to their own exposure, right? Aise hi hota hai. I worked as an expat thrice in my career. So maine England mein bhi kaam kiya hai, Singapore mein bhi kiya hai, Indonesia mein bhi kiya hai, Bahrain mein bhi kiya hai. I have realized ki bada time lagta hai local ko jaake wahan settle hone mein, aur fir by the time you realize ki mujhe kya karna chahiye tha, 2-3 saal guzar chuke hote hain. Beshak aapke paas passport ho, immigration ho, agar ek community, settled expert community aapki guidance ke liye maujood ho aur aapko na sirf orient kare balki help kare in getting connected to the local community, then you can imagine ki kya nahi ho sakta, you know, whether it comes to getting a business started or whether it comes to starting a career. So PHCF would endeavor to do that exactly. और उसका फ़ायदा क्या होएगा, एक तो पाकिस्तानी कम्युनिटी एक दूसरे को स्ट्रेंथन करेगी, बिकॉज व्हाट आई सी ऑल ओवर द वर्ल्ड, आई गो एज अ स्पीकर ऑल ओवर द वर्ल्ड एंड आई रियलाइज के इंटरनेशनल कम्युनिटीज़ में जिन कंट्रीज़ ने एक्सेल किया है वो वाली कम्युनिटीज़ हैं, वो हैव डन वेरी वेल टुगेदर एज अ टीम, नॉट एज एन इंडिविजुअल. सो आपको एक इंडियन इंडिविजुअल शायद नज़र नहीं आएगा, पहले आपको एक इंडियन फॉरम नज़र आएगा, इसी तरह आपको एक चाइनीज़ फॉरम नज़र आएगा, चाइनीज़ कम्युनिटी नज़र आएगी, वट एवर यू मे कॉल इट, आपको रशियन फॉरम नज़र आएगा. सो उन्होंने तो इवन टाउन्स तक अपने नाम के बनाए हुए ना, लिटिल इंडिया, चाइना टाउन, राइट, हाउस ऑफ फॉर एग्जाम्पल रशिया. सो वट आई वॉन्ट टू सी इज़ दैट पाकिस्तानी नज़र आएँ एज अ कम्युनिटी, और आई एम श्योर कि बहुत सारे अच्छे प्रोफेशनल्स अपनी अपनी कम्युनिटी चला रहे हैं. लेकिन जब हमने अमेरिका में लोगों से बात की तो उन्होंने कहा कि पाकिस्तानी अमेरिकन डॉक्टर्स की कम्युनिटी है, पाकिस्तानी कंप्यूटिंग प्रोफेशनल्स की कम्युनिटी है, हर प्रोफेशन की कम्युनिटी है. ऐसी कम्युनिटी नहीं है जो सारे प्रोफेशंस को ऑन करती हो क्रॉस फंक्शनली, यू नो, एंड क्रॉस कंट्री एंड क्रॉस आई मीन एरियाज. सो PHCF वॉन्ट टू बी अ कम्युनिटी ऑफ ऑल पाकिस्तानीज, नॉट पाकिस्तानी डॉक्टर्स एंड नॉट पाकिस्तानी HR ओनली. उससे फ़ायदा क्या होता है, सब एक दूसरे के साथ आ जाते हैं. दूसरा हमने कहा कि ये जो हम अपनी जो डिफरेंशिएटिंग फैक्टर्स हमारे हैं फॉरम के, वो मैं आपको भी कुछ दिखाऊंगा अभी स्लाइड्स पे, वो ये हैं कि हम कैसे अपने आप को अदर देन बेस्ट प्रैक्टिस शेयरिंग डिफरेंशिएट कर पाते हैं एज अ फॉरम. तो हमने पाकिस्तान में अपने आप को कैसे डिफरेंशिएट किया ये मैं आपको बता देता हूँ. हर फॉरम में ज़्यादातर हम एक्सचेंज करते हैं बेस्ट प्रैक्टिस या नेटवर्क करके चले आते हैं. सो वी थॉट कि ये काफ़ी नहीं है, नेटवर्किंग काफ़ी नहीं है. और नेटवर्किंग इसलिए काफ़ी नहीं है बिकॉज व्हेन यू स्टार्ट एक्सचेंजिंग आइडियाज़ पीपल से कि यार हम तो ऑलरेडी 10 फॉरम्स में जा रहे हैं, यू नो, हमें तो कराची में फॉर एग्जांपल माशाल्लाह देयर सो मेनी कॉन्फ्रेंसेज एंड इवेंट्स. सो आप कैसे डिफरेंशिएट करें, सो देन वी स्टार्टेड डूइंग टू थिंग्स. वी स्टार्टेड वर्किंग विद आर यूथ, तो वी स्टार्टेड कॉलिंग इट अ यूथ कनेक्ट इनिशिएटिव. ठीक है, यूथ कनेक्ट किया है कि कैंपस टू कैरियर ड्राइव्स करानी शुरू कर दी पाकिस्तान में. सो हमने कहा कि अगर हम लाहौर बैठे हैं तो लेट्स टॉक टू लम्स एंड लेट्स टॉक टू अदर. और लम्स के अभी पिछले 5 साल में जितने HR कॉन्फ्रेंसेज हुए हैं, जिसको वो HR इवेंट को HR कॉन्फ्रेंस कहते हैं, वो PHCF ने कराए, हमारे फॉरम ने कराए, इन द सेंस ऑफ डिजाइनिंग इट एंड देन हेल्प देम एग्जीक्यूटिंग इट. सो कॉन्फ्रेंसेज इन बिजनेस स्कूल्स, गिविंग देम द आर्म ऑफ द कॉर्पोरेट सेक्टर, जो स्पीकर चाहिए वी वुड अरेंज, यू नो, अगर कोई कंपटीशन हो रहा है वी विल डिज़ाइन इट फॉर देम. अगर ऑडियंस चाहिए कॉर्पोरेट की, वी विल गिव द कॉर्पोरेट ऑडियंस. और इससे फ़ायदा क्या होता है, यूनिवर्सिटी को जो सपोर्ट चाहिए होती है वो उसके पास शायद वो इतना एक्सटेंडेड आर्म नहीं होता कॉर्पोरेट का जितना कॉर्पोरेट फॉरम के पास होता है. सो वी स्टार्ट डूइंग इट विद लम्स. देन वी टॉक टू द नॉर्थ एंड वी सेड कि हम आपकी इस्लामाबाद में भी आपको सपोर्ट करना चाहते हैं. तो वी स्टार्टेड विद टॉकिंग टू NUST. NUST बिजनेस स्कूल के मेजॉरिटी जो कॉर्पोरेट इवेंट्स की होती है उसको PHCF सपोर्ट करता है एंड दिस इज़ एक्सटेंडेड विदाउट एनी चार्जेस टू एनी वन. लम्स वुड मेक मनी आउट ऑफ देयर कॉन्फ्रेंस द वे दे वॉन्ट टू मेक मनी. वी विल जस्ट हेल्प देम इम्प्रूविंग द क्वालिटी ऑफ द डिज़ाइन एंड क्वालिटी ऑफ द प्रोसेस, पूरा जो कॉन्फ्रेंस का एक्सपीरियंस है. अच्छा, फिर हमने फास्ट से बात की तो फास्ट वॉज ऑल्सो वेरी वेलकमिंग. सो हमने इस्लामाबाद में फास्ट के साथ चीज़ें करानी शुरू कर दी. राइट नाउ पिछले कोई 6 सालों में 180 से ज़्यादा यूथ कनेक्ट सेशन हम करा चुके हैं नॉर्थ के अंदर. और वो हमने मुख्तलिफ हमने ये नहीं किया कि सिर्फ डिस्क्रिमिनेट कर देंगे सिर्फ एक कैंपस में, हमने सबके साथ किया. हुएवर वॉज विलिंग we gave them the speakers, we gave them the, you know, the corporate audience side of it. Obviously unki apni academia ki audience unhone arrange ki. Acha, iska fayda kya hua, jab aap students ko for example CV coaching, interview coaching, career coaching ke upar sessions karate hain, to students ke liye it become very easy to correlate to what the corporate sector would like to have in the terms of their readiness. To humne unki readiness ko badha diya. Phir humne apne forum ke portals ke upar aur WhatsApp ke upar jobs share karni shuru kar di स्टूडेंट्स के साथ, जो ग्रेजुएटिंग स्टूडेंट्स हैं उनकी एकेडमिया फैकल्टी के साथ. तो उसका फ़ायदा ये हुआ कि लॉट ऑफ पीपल जो ऑब्जर्वर्स आए थे हमारे फॉरम्स के अंदर एज ग्रेजुएटिंग स्टूडेंट्स आर नाउ इनटू द कॉर्पोरेट सेक्टर बिकॉज दे वर एबल टू इंटरेक्ट विद आर पीपल, यू नो, दे गॉट जॉब्स. एंड इन द लास्ट अगेन आई वुड से 180 सेशंस अराउंड 6,000 स्टूडेंट्स गॉट जॉब्स, मोर देन दैट. अच्छा, वो जो 6,000 बचा था वो सिर्फ ऑब्जर्वर था, अगेन वी डिडंट चार्ज एनीथिंग. ये मैं इसलिए बार बार एम्फोसाइज़ करूँ कि उसकी वैल्यू हम चाह रहे थे कि एकेडमिया को मिले हमारी वजह से, और हम चाह रहे हैं कि मज़ीद मिले. तो अब हमने न्यूयॉर्क में भी ये किया है कि वहाँ तो सिर्फ पाकिस्तानी स्टूडेंट नहीं है. सो हमारी जो वहाँ पे कोर टीम है वो जब जाके यूथ कनेक्ट सेशन कराएगी फॉर एग्जाम्पल न्यूयॉर्क यूनिवर्सिटी में कराएगी, तो वी आर नॉट टारगेटिंग ओनली पाकिस्तानी स्टूडेंट्स दैर, वी आर टारगेटिंग एवरी स्टूडेंट हु वॉन्ट्स टू बी पार्ट ऑफ दैट सेशन. दैट इज़ अगेन अ वे ऑफ गिविंग बैक टू द सोसाइटी. अच्छा, तीसरी चीज़ हमने कहा कि अब एक और डिफरेंशिएटिंग फैक्टर हम ये कर सकते हैं कि हम मेंटोरिंग पे आ जाते हैं. मेंटोरिंग कैसे करें? सो फॉर एग्जाम्पल ये आपके सामने एक सैम्पल स्लाइड है, हमने अभी ये लास्ट इस्लामाबाद में जो सेशन कराया था तो वी हैड दीज स्पीकर्स सो देर लाइक 7-8 CHRO CEOs हमने कहा कि एक पावर नेटवर्किंग टी रखते हैं जहाँ पे स्टूडेंट पहले आके एक वर्कशॉप अटेंड करे कैंपस टू कैरियर उसके बाद ये जो पैनल है और इस तरह के हमने कोई 150 लोग बुला लिए इस्लामाबाद में इनको हम असाइन कर दें उसी वक्त उन मेंटीज के साथ एंड दे स्टार्ट अ मेंटरिंग रिलेशनशिप इस तरह हम पहले भी करते रहे मेंटरिंग रिलेशनशिप से क्या मुराद है कि एक फ्रंटियर का फॉर एग्जांपल एग्जेक्टिव है वो एक ग्रेजुएटिंग स्टूडेंट को मेंटर कर रहा है एक टॉप टीयर का एग्जेक्टिव है जो एक मिड टीयर के प्रोफेशनल को मेंटर कर रहा है और अगर टॉप टीयर का मेंटी खुद मेंटर होना चाह रहा है तो दे वुड रिक्वेस्ट अस कि जी हमें एक फरा एंटरप्रेन्योर से हमें मेंटरिंग आप कनेक्ट कर दें रिलेशनशिप हमारी डेवलप कर दें तो वी वुड ऑल्सो डू दैट यू नो ऑन द रिक्वेस्ट ऑफ द मेंटी हु इज सपोज टू बी अ मेंबर ऑफ द फोरम ठीक है सो उसका फायदा क्या हुआ कि सम पीपल सेड CHRO कॉल्ड मी सेड कि आई वांट रजाक दाऊद टू बी माय मेंटर और आई वांट बाबर अली टू बी माय मेंटर इन लाहौर सो वी सेड ओके व्हाट वी कैन डू इज टू सबमिट अ रिक्वेस्ट टू द एंटरप्रेन्योर्स दैट यू आर टॉकिंग अबाउट एंड देन क्रिएट दिस रिलेशनशिप फॉर यू उसके बाद आपने खुद मैनेज करना है उसको लाइक फॉर एग्जाम्पल आप फोर्टनाइटली मिलते हैं आप मंथली मिलते हैं आप क्वार्टरली मिलते हैं ये मेंटर और मेंटी की रिलेशनशिप की हेल्थ पे है We would just enable it. We'll not push it, obviously, because these are very senior people. But then when we started doing it, a lot of professionals were able to connect to mentees. So this mentoring ka vertical tha hamara, ye bahut strong ho gaya north ke andar. So ab humne ja ke UAE mein jab is model ko present kiya, to the friends in the UAE also said ki kisi forum mein ye nahi humne hote hue dekha. क्योंकि कंपनी टू कंपनी तो मेंटरिंग होती है इंडस्ट्री वाइज भी शायद होती है एट टाइम्स अभी जब मैं कोका कोला में था माय लास्ट जॉब वाज विद कोका कोला पाकिस्तान तो कोक ने नेस्ले के साथ एक एग्रीमेंट किया हुआ था जहाँ पे जो कोक की सी लेवल टीम थी वो नेस्ले की C-1 को मेंटर कर रही थी और नेस्ले की जो सी लेवल थी वो कोक की C-1 को मेंटर कर रही थी सो देयर वाज क्रॉस कंपनी विद इन द सेम इंडस्ट्री FMCG लेकिन ये नहीं होता कि एक फॉरम है जो कह रहा है कि जी हम आपको मेंटर भी दे देते हैं एंड अगेन नो चार्जेस अगर आप सिर्फ मेंबर हैं तो आप मेंटी हैं और अगर आप मेंबर नहीं भी हैं तो आप मेंटर हो सकते हैं और वो मेंटर जो है वो फिर खुद ओन कर रहा है क्योंकि ऑब्वियसली आर मेंटर्स आर वेरी सीनियर पीपल सो दे वुड रादर ओन इट मच मोर देन द मेंटी सो हमें इसमें जहाँ भी प्रॉब्लम हुआ आज तक वो ये हुआ है कि मेंटी अवेलेबल नहीं था ये कभी भी नहीं हुआ कि मेंटर अवेलेबल नहीं था बिकॉज मेंटर वुड कम फॉर अ पर्पस राइट वो बल्कि हमें फ़ोन करके पूछ रहे होते हैं कि मेंटी का क्या प्लान है मेंटी ने क्या किया क्योंकि ऑब्वियसली जूनियर लोग एट दैट टाइम यू डोंट सी दैट सीरियसनेस बट मेंटर्स आर वेरी सीरियस इट्स अ सीरियस बिजनेस आई मीन यू आर चेंजिंग समबडी इज लाइफ राइट ये जब हमने किया दुबई में तो दुबई वॉज एक्साइटेड दे सेड कि वी आर हैप्पी टू सी दिस अगर आप हमें क्रॉस कंट्री भी कोई नेशनल दे दें तो वी आर ऑल्सो हैप्पी विद दैट कि यू नो एक पाकिस्तानी को एक अमेरिकन कर रहा है मेंटर यू नो या एक पाकिस्तानी को कोई स्पेनिश कर रहा है मेंटर हु इज देयर इन द इंडस्ट्री इन द सेम कंट्री So that we are yet to do, but हमने plan किया कि दुबई से हम ये भी start करते हैं कि हम cross nationality mentoring करानी शुरू कर देते हैं But obviously there's so much wisdom in the world, और दुबई is the home to that wisdom. There are like more than 220 countries जो दुबई में operate कर रहे हैं इनके experts. तो ये तो बड़ा अच्छा हो जाएगा अगर cross country expert भी एक दूसरे को mentor कर सके फिर हमने एक चौथी बात ये की कि international best practice sharing कैसे करें अब अमेरिका में जो लोग बैठे हैं they would like to see the European perspective. And the Europeans would like to see the Asian perspective. Ab majority jo emerging markets hain wo ya Asia mein hai ya Africa mein hai. So ye connect bhi ab humne build karna shuru kar diya ki humne we have started sending people from Europe to US as speakers. Again wo zaruri nahi hai hamare platform pe ho kyunki abhi hamara platform wahan pe strengthen ho raha hai. Lekin jab humne apna platform build kar diya ek dafa to phir ye cross continent bhi ho jayega. Acha and that necessarily doesn't mean ke sirf Pakistani speaker hoega. तो अगर फॉर एग्जांपल कोई हमारा यूरोपियन मेंबर जाके अमेरिकन ऑडियंस से बात करना चाहता है तो वी वुड आल्सो क्रिएट दैट लिंक एंड देन देयर आई मेट द यूएस एम्बेसडर जो यूएस एम्बेसडर पाकिस्तानी एम्बेसडर टू यूएस इन यूएस और मैंने उनसे ये रिक्वेस्ट की कि जब इस तरह की कोई अपॉर्चुनिटी आती है तो आई वुड रिक्वेस्ट द एम्बेसडर टू बी देयर एज वेल बिकॉज दैट रिप्रेजेंट्स पाकिस्तान ठीक है अगर कोई फॉरेन स्पीकर आ रहा है और एक पाकिस्तानी ऑडियंस से बात कर रहा है तो फिर पाकिस्तान की जो एम्बेसी है यूएस में उसको ऑन करें And he was very happy to note kis tarah he said ki it is part of our mission in US to support Pakistani communities. Aur agar aap is tarah ki community build kar rahe hain, to ye to it strengthens our mission because it strengthens the brand of Pakistan. To isi tarah ab I'm going to Germany 25th May ko hum Germany launch kar rahe hain, which is PHCF Central Europe. And we've already made a core team over there as well. Wahan pe bhi ab yehi idea hum share kar rahe hain ki jo European diaspora hai Pakistani. So there are 350,000 Pakistanis in UK only who are working in UK. And if you look at the larger number, more than 500,000 Pakistanis work in Western Europe. So imagine isko agar hum scale up kar dein to ye to bahut bada number hai jisko hum touch kar sakte hain Europe ke andar sirf. So here I would stop. I would like to speak more about it, but end mein hum jab conclude karenge panel ko to fir we'll conclude with some announcements about Karachi. I am now giving the mic to Nushad. Nushad is our chapter lead for PHCF Mehran chapter, and he's a seasoned HR professional himself. I know a lot of you may know him already, but I'll just introduce him. Jitna mujhe yaad hai Nushad ka introduction, wo main kara deta hun. His introduction is always deeper than what I can recall. So Nushad has been in the industry for more than 2 decades now. He has been into various OD and learning and people excellence roles. So Nushad se jab main mila tha, to Nushad us waqt Telenor mein director the organizational excellence ke, that is long time back. And at that time he was heading the culture and people agenda in Telenor. And then he went on to become the executive vice president in organization development and talent for PTCL. And then he went on to Karachi. And then he was recently the executive vice president in Bank Al-Fala. He has been an OD consultant. He has been a speaker on various HR domains in Pakistan and abroad. And Nushad is very much known for developing organization development solutions in various industries. He has a lot of mentees in Pakistan, jo PHCF ne bhi inko provide kiye aur inke pehle se bhi the, which have, you know, learned a lot from his ability to develop organization development solutions in Pakistan. So ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to now invite Nushad Javed.
Okay, thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum, everyone. Thank you very much, all of you, for coming in here. Adil has talked a lot about PHCF and what we plan to do with PHCF, and the fact that it is a voluntary and a non-for-profit organization. But one thing that he probably forgot to mention was that we started PHCF Mehran chapter a few years back, and then for one reason or the other, the Mehran chapter got a bit of inactive. So this is actually also, this particular day, this particular occasion also marks the relaunch of the Mehran chapter. So for all those of you who are coming here for the very first time, and for those of you who have registered previously, you know, so like to welcome you back from the bottom of my heart. So as Adil has mentioned, my name is Nushad. I will be the moderator for this session. So thank you. So as you may have already seen in the brochures, the session today is about talent, and we're going to touch upon various aspects of talent. One of the things that we are going to talk about is repatriation, which is something which I see happening a lot now in Pakistan. A lot of people from the Middle East specifically are coming back into Pakistan. A lot of bankers are coming back into Pakistan. What are they experiencing? What should happen? How should the companies in Pakistan, you know, what needs to be provided to those Pakistanis who were expats and now they're coming back into Pakistan? So we're going to touch base on that. Then we are also going to discuss the element of coaching and how important it is in terms of retaining talent. I'm sure that a lot of us are familiar with talent, with the idea of talent management, what we can do to manage and grow our own leaders, which is all about talent management. So we're going to touch base ke coaching uske andar kya role play karti hai, and if coaching does play a role, then what are organizations doing about it? Are organizations actively looking into coaching? Are they hiring coaches? Do they have internal coaches? Do they believe in that entire concept of whether or not coaching is an effective intervention in the organization to retain your talented people? And then obviously the last thing that we're going to talk about is the millennials, which is actually the first thing that we're going to start with. So we have three presentations, and millennials, and I was at a conference yesterday, and I got to find out from a very senior, from a CEO of a large company here in Pakistan, in Karachi, that there is actually another generation that has already, it's already there, right? So I think Anas is probably going to touch upon that, and they're called the centennials. तो ये मुझे कल ही पता चला, मैं तो अभी मिलेनियल्स में फंसा हुआ था, मुझे पता चला कि अब सेंटिनियल्स भी कोई चीज़ आ गई है. सो यू नो, सो आई एम ब्लैंक एज फार एज दैट इज़ कंसर्न. सो यू नो, वी गोइंग टू हैव अ डिस्कशन ऑन दैट, होपफुली अ गुड डिस्कशन ऑन दैट. So to make this and to take this forward, we have invited some distinguished professionals from the industry. So I would like to invite all of them on the stage. So first of all, I would like to invite Anas Ahmed. Anas, would you please come on the stage here? Maybe you can have a seat over there. Yes, thank you very much. Would you like to introduce yourself, Anas, please?
Thanks, Naushad. Assalamu alaikum everyone, my name is Anas Ahmed. I am currently at Venture Dive, which is a tech company. It's popularly known by the company that created Kareem. I'm over there as Director HR and Corporate Communications. Before that, I've worked mostly with the multinationals. I've worked with Shell, Telenor, Ufone, etc. Within similar roles.
Thank you very much, Anas. And I've also recently found out that Kareem employees are really happy employees today, huh? Because everyone got good, you know, returns on their investment by investing in the stocks and Kareem. Okay. We also have Barrister Nausheen. Barrister Nausheen, if you could please join us here on the stage. A round of applause, yes. Ma'am, would you like to introduce yourself, please?
Assalamu alaikum. As Naushad Saab said, my name is Nausheen Ahmed. I am a barrister by profession. I have worked in a number of companies, Unilever, ICI Pakistan, where I currently am, but I've done two stints at ICI. I spent 10 years with them and then left and moved to the banking sector, to HBL. And I spent 12 years with HBL and returned to ICI. So it's been quite a career.
Thank you very much. Welcome. And then we have the CHRO of Hascol, Mr. M. Saad Shah Hussain, please. Welcome, please. A brief intro, sir.
All right. Well, I'm an engineer MBA, and I have a long career, and mostly it's been in the petroleum and engineering sectors. I was country general manager of British Petroleum, and then BHP Billiton, which is a very large Australian company. I've also worked in Pakistani joint ventures with Abu Dhabi, which is the Parco, and currently I'm with Hascol Petroleum as CHRO and head of corporate planning.
Thank you. Welcome, sir. And last but not the least, we have also invited a great personality, and that you're going to hear, you know, some of the things that he has to say. I would like to welcome Mr. Asad Rizvi, please. So, Asad, a little intro. Yes. Go ahead.
My name is Asad Rizvi. I used to be the Chief Transformation Officer at Wateen Telecom, helped to turn the company around. I have a fairly unusual background. I used to be, before that, in Silicon Valley, where I did a startup. I have a degree in psychology, and I've worked with a lot of athletes, professional athletes, helped them really up their game. Came to the corporate sector here in Pakistan, and I run a consulting firm called Veritas Ventures, and our core focus is to actually make employees, organizations, extremely productive. So if it's an organization that's failing, we turn it around. If it's an organization that's stagnating, or if it's an organization that needs some extraordinary breakthrough solutions, we've got a framework to do that.
All right, thank you very much. So a round of applause for all the panelists, please. तालियां जोर से बजा लें. All right, G. So what we're going to do is we're going to have our first presentation. This first presentation will be by Anas, and he is going to address the issue or the challenge or the opportunity of millennials. So over to you, Anas.
Okay. Thank you, guys. So I am limited time, so I'll try to, yes, thanks, be as quick as possible. I'm not sure when you heard about the topic, what you guys were expecting. I hope I cover a lot of your expectations that you come up here with. I recently was invited to a conference in London where I presented this, so I got pretty good feedback. I thought it's very important that we share this same information over here. So I would like to keep this session as interactive as possible, and that is why I'm going to start off with a few questions, just to help us all understand what exactly is it that we're talking about. Okay, so question number one. All HR professionals here, so a sense of belonging in an organization has been found to be related with which one of these outcomes? Please raise your hands, whoever thinks it's the first one. Increased employee productivity, reduced employee turnover, increased sales, increased innovation, higher customer spending. I'm sure all of you knew it's all of the above. Nothing new here. I'm sure all the HR professionals in this room knew this was coming, right? Next question. The UN, now this is where it gets interesting. The US Department of Labor estimated that today's high school graduates expects to have how many jobs before they turn 40? Any guesses? 14? Anybody else? 5 to 8, 8 to 10, it's 10 to 14. So this is just to build the understanding. These are the kind of people, so we're talking about millennials and centennials. These are the people who are around the age of 30 or less than 30 right now. This is what they're expecting. So as HR professionals, all of us over here, this is the kind of challenge we're dealing with. This is less than 2 years in a job, which is expected. Okay, next question. According to a US survey, what percent of US workforce worked as freelancers in 2017? Any guesses? 5%, 13%, 36 to 50%. It's 36%. That's very high. This number was almost zero just 10 years ago. It has skyrocketed. And this is going to go up, right? What percentage of UK workforce was working from home or remotely? 13, 22, 35%, 50%, 66%. 50, 35, Adil says 36, it's 50%. In a recent survey, US employees, how many of them claim not to be engaged or actively disengaged? 40, 64, 72, 87, 92. 87. 87%. This is a very high number, right? So, in short, all of us here, we have a challenge on our hands. This is a challenge never faced before. Every generation of HR professionals faces different sort of challenges. This is our challenge. The challenge is, our millennials or the newer workforce is not attracted to the same benefits. Their average spending time in an at an employer is less than 2 years. Freelance workers are increasing. Remote flexible work is increasing. This was something that was not there before, right? How many of you are parents? They had one job their entire career, their entire life. Maximum 2 jobs, 3 jobs. Over here, now we're dealing with a population that want to change their job every 2 years, right? And they have many more options. They don't really have to do a job all the time. They can do freelance work. They can become entrepreneurs. They have lots of options available. And employee engagement is decreasing, right? Now, the talk here is a little bit different from what you might have expected, because generally, when you talk about millennials or retention of people, whether it is millennials or others, generally this is what people talk about. You know, better pay structures, flexible and remote working options, you create a really nice looking office that's spanking like Google, health and well-being benefits, learning and development, CSR, the list goes on. But these are very concrete. There are lots of information on these available already, right? And lots of talks have been done about these. In my opinion, I don't think, although these are very, very important, I don't think these are sustainable. These will help you retain those people for a short period of time. You will have to continuously improve on them, but these will not be sustainable enough to help you retain this talent, millennials, and the upcoming generations for the long term. Why? The answer is simple, because these are easily toppable, right? One day you have a better pay scale, another company will come along, they will have bigger budgets, deeper pockets than you have. You have a certain budget for learning and development, another company will come along, they'll have a higher budget. Everything, you know, I mean, you build a great office, another company will build a better one. We need sustainable solution. And in my opinion, the sustainable solution is developing a purpose, a sense of belonging in employees. Now, generally, people talk about this a lot, but it's very difficult to gain commitment from the heart. All HR professionals, from one time to the other, we made purpose statements, mission statements, vision statements to hang them on the walls. They don't work because there is a reason to this, right? I'll give you an example. Cathy O'Dowd, she was one of the first females to reach the Mount Everest summit, right? And somebody asked them, how was the experience? This is how she explained her experience. And she said, the team was created. It was such an important, she's a South African, so it was a very important sort of, at that point in time, the initiative of the South African government. Nelson Mandela was the president. And he said, Nelson Mandela called the team of 10 mountaineers, sat them down, told us this is a very important element in their history, right? So they went on. When they reached the base camp, those 10 people, the team, started bickering amongst themselves, right? Grouping ho gayi, nobody liked the leader, and by day 5, they were all not even talking to each other, right? And then on the day of the summit, they saw a helicopter, uske piche South African flag tha, and that was going by, right? Everybody got out, looked at the flag, and in that moment, they didn't even speak to each other. In their eyes, they knew, this is what we are here for. So nothing basically unites people than a compelling sense of purpose. And that's what we need to create in our people if we want to retain our millennials in the long run. But once again, I mean, this is not life-changing information. All of you know this. I know none of you in your seats are sitting, oh, Anas, you've changed our life. Why didn't we meet you sooner? But it's very difficult because majority of the purposes that are made are useless. Most of them we don't have a role to play in. Sometimes we do get that opportunity that we get to play a role in, but we don't take enough time to you know, sell that purpose to our people. I'll skip this personal example because this is a bit longer, but what's the difference between a useless purpose and a compelling one, right? That's the most important part. The big myth is that, you know, people feel as long as you put in the right words in the purpose, it becomes, I mean, they focus on the sexiness of the purpose, really, right? Even in your companies, if you ask somebody what's the purpose or your purpose or the organizational purpose, generally the response will be, you know, they'll think about it, they'll try to remember it, they'll say usme transformation aata hai, usme changing lives aata hai, making people's life better aata hai, but they won't remember it because we haven't sold that purpose. They don't buy into that purpose, right? So the idea is that people spend too much time they spend too much time on making it sound really good rather than selling it to the people. So how do we come up with a good sounding purpose? And that's the most difficult part, because emotional commitment kisi ki win karna, that is not easy, right? So I have a few, you know, about how do you win in emotional commitment. Most of the companies or individuals are at this stage. They know their purpose or they understand their purpose, but they're not bought into the purpose. And until that happens, they won't really, you know, buy into it. So how do we make this happen? I have a few ideas. Now, unless you're a Martin Luther King, great at talking, which I'm not, you won't be able to inspire people just through your words, right? So you need visualizations, you need stories, and day-to-day actions. these three, I think, are key areas on how you're going to make sure this purpose is sold to the people. So I have a small example. I don't know if this is going to... Can you... Oh. Yeah, so a small example of a video.
It's not time to make a change. Just relax, take it easy. You're still young, that's your fault. There's so much you have to know. Find a girl, settle down. If you want, you can marry. Look at me, I am old, but I'm happy. I was once like you are now, and I know that it's not easy to be calm when you found something going on. But take your time, think a lot. I think of everything you've got, for you will still be here tomorrow, but your dreams may not.
Now, nothing I could have said would have delivered the message in this way, right? I could have told you, keep in touch with your parents, unka khyaal rakhein, one day they won't be here, right? But nothing I would have said would have delivered the message the way this 30-second video has been able to deliver. So it's very difficult to get the emotional commitment of the people, and that's how we need to spend more time in selling the purpose that we believe in, right? What's the other thing? So that's one part of it, right? Selling the purpose. How do we build a sense of belonging? That's very important. How many of you know about Zappos? Right? Zappos is a shoe company. It's owned by Amazon. It's one of those companies that was bought by Amazon for $1.2 billion, right? It's primarily, it came into light because of the culture that they had, right? And if you see the videos that they're out there about Zappos, you'll realize that if you go into a Zappos office, it's like a fish market, right? There's nothing clean about it. And everybody's having fun. They're doing all sorts of stuff over there. When people asked him, how do you get work done? The idea that the CEO of Zappos shared was that all these people enjoy this fish market, right? They feel part of the culture, it's sense of belonging over there. It's like being part of a family. Our families, all of our families are weird in one way or the other. But we feel part of their family because we are weird in the same way. And it's about how you collect the same weirdness in one company, put them all together, then everybody feels welcome and everybody feels part of that culture. So the idea is, how do you make people in an organization feel like they're working for a unique organization? There are a few ways of doing this. The first one is have a unique sense of purpose, like a special purpose, something that nobody else is doing. Your company or you are working towards something that nobody else is tackling, whatever that may be. And that makes you unique. And that way, all the people who care about that particular area will come together. The second area could be by surrounding them with special people. Everybody wants to work for a company that is recognized because the kind of people that they have. The McKinsey's of the world, right? The Boston Consulting Group. The companies that everyone knows are the companies that are known for having the best people, a certain kind of people, and everybody wants to be part of that group. That makes people stick. The third is, how do you create a special working environment, like the example of Zappos or so many other companies that are there, Google, not because of their office only, but there are other things also. Then by selling special products, right? For example, the automated limbs, that companies are selling. If that's something people are passionate about because they feel they're helping lots of people by producing those limbs, then that is a special purpose of that organization and people will feel connected to that organization. And finally, by treating them in special ways, right? You make them feel special as part of that organization, that's all. Everybody, each one of us wants to feel special. It's no secret, it's human nature, right? So how do you create that specialness around those people? That's very important. Unfortunately, we spend too much time trying to create this feeling that we want to be a great employer, a good employer, rather than focusing on that specialness or the uniqueness of that. And finally, a little bit about culture, that I think two things are very, very important over here. Our culture is created by day-to-day behaviors. That's one of the most important things. If the leadership team, everyone involved in the team, is not depicting those behaviors, people will not buy into it. And the second thing is, small things make a big impact. Generally, what you see in organizations is, there will be suddenly a realization that we want to do something about culture or our values. There'll be 2-month-long sessions. Everyone in the organization will be going crazy. But there has nothing that happened before that. Nothing will happen after that. And that's not how you build culture. You build culture by day-to-day actions, small things. Small example of that is Andy Murray. He was trying to win the Wimbledon and the Grand Slam for a number of years and failing. Finally, when he won and people asked him, what did you do to win this? He said, I didn't make one radical change that made me win it. He said, I made small changes in every area of my game, and that's how I was able to win it. So small changes make a big difference. So finally, to summarize, unite the people through a compelling sense of purpose. Because once again, the data that I shared about millennials, they won't stick around for all the other things that you're doing. You will continuously improve them. You will still continue to lose them. I know this because I work for a tech company. It's 300 people strong. The turnover is very, very high. The average age is around 26 years old. And it's very, very difficult to retain them. In other organizations, in multinationals, I feel it's different because they have a younger workforce that's coming in right now, but they also have an older workforce that complements each other. The true brunt of turnover or the millennial workforce is faced by the companies that have come up in, let's say, the past 10 years. Make them feel they work for a unique organization and build a sense of culture of belonging. Final thought. You knew this already. I've reinforced this, but probably most of you already knew this, but that still does not mean you're going to go and do it. This example here, there was a study that was conducted of 100 people who suffered heart attacks. Okay? All those people who suffered heart attacks and then they were able to come out of that heart attack. So the doctors, they said to them that obviously when you have any condition, you sort of know what's wrong with you, right? For heart attack, cholesterol kam karein, oil kam karein, these are the food or things to eat, these are the things not to eat, right? And they gave them a whole guideline. And then they monitored those 100 people for the next 6 months. Now, these are the people who came back from heart attacks. In 1 month, about 10 of those people had gone back to their old habits. In 2 months, about 20 of them had gone back. In 6 months, 99 of them had gone back to their old habits that caused the heart attack in the first place. Only one of them was able to survive or follow through with the doctor's opinion. So the idea is just because you know it doesn't mean you're going to do it. So my last thought is be the one, not the 99, right? Go back, be persistent. These things take time. Be persistent and consistent, and that's how you will be able to change this. Okay, thank you.
Very well spoken, Anas. I have many things to say and to ask, but I will hold on to that, and I would also request you to hold on to your thoughts and your questions in the interest of time. I will now request for the second presentation, which will be made by Mr. Saad Hussain Saab. So, Saad Saab, over to you, sir.
I got a call a couple of weeks back from Kamran saying that, would you like to talk at this event? And I said, okay. But he said, you're going to talk on repatriation. So this topic has been forced on me. And because I'm not an expert on repatriation, what does an expert do? He goes and talks to people. And he gets their opinions and he puts them together and then he presents it like an expert. So I will not pretend to be an expert. But what I have done is that as I've been teaching at IBA and also at CBM since 1984, I'm one of those traditionalists, if you may want to call me. I got hold of about 10 students and also about 50 expats, Pakistani expats who've come back, and I've put together this presentation, which is basically starting from primary data and then giving some thoughts and feedback from them. So what I'm going to cover is the nature and quantum of Pakistani talent abroad, where it is located, what are the personal and professional factors which influence expats, Pakistani expats, when they come back, and what are the possible initiatives that we can employ to facilitate these, and particularly a little focus on the young talent that we have. So let me start by giving you some data. You'll be surprised that Bangladesh has the highest number of people who are working in the region outside their own country. And this is after a drop of about 250,000 people last year, despite that. So there must have been about a million Bangladeshis working outside Bangladesh. Of course, Pakistan is number two, and a country as large as India has got much fewer people. And we look at, as we go down in the slides, that it's not really the number of people, it's the quality of people that matters. If you look at Pakistani talent itself, till the year 2015, we continued to increase the export of our talent abroad. But after 2015, because most of our talent goes to the GCC countries and Saudi Arabia, and we've seen what is happening over there in terms of the economy, oil prices, and so on, we find that the talent export is reducing very considerably. Now, this is now posing questions for us. If this talent export is reducing, what are we going to do about that? The other thing that we've also noticed is that a large part of the talent is going to the UAE and to the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. And you will find that these curves are more or less running parallel, 2017 and 2018. And most of the 96% of this talent is basically in GCC countries, and then the rest of it is basically sprinkled all over in different countries of the world. So our volume is going there, but the value may be coming from somewhere else. Now, if you look at, again, this is a similar graph, but it tells us what is the countrywide, that was region, this is countrywide. So again, we see that it's UAE and Saudi Arabia and other countries in the Middle East also. Now, as I said earlier, it's not the volume of talent, it is also the quality of talent, the skill behind the talent. And we find that in 2017 and 18, there is a considerable drop in the requirement of unskilled and semi-skilled people. Whereas here, in recent times, in the last even in 1 year, we are finding that the demand for higher qualified talent or talent which has got more skills is increasing. So what we anticipate in the future is that as economies slow down, the nature of work changes even in these Middle Eastern countries, we will find that the volume of our labor will be reduced and the value addition which is required from our people will be demanded, which means that there will be more export of professionals and expats which have higher qualifications. So there is going to be a change in the mix of expats that we are going to see in the future. And therefore our strategy, if we want to bring them back, also has to change. So my focus is trying to target the high value segment of our expats and not the labor segment of our expats. And if you look at this analysis, you will find that the increase in demand is largely for professionals across the Pakistani diaspora. And there is a considerable decrease in the demand for job categories for people who are unskilled or semi-skilled. So what we are finding is that there is an increase of 10s and 20% of people who are having professional qualifications such as engineers, teachers, doctors, and so on and so forth. So there is a shift in the demand for expats from Pakistan. And of course, these people are largely responsible for a very sustainable kind of foreign exchange input into the country. And despite the problems that we are facing, we are still looking at about $20 billion worth. So they are a very important source of human capital, as Al-Sahab also mentioned. And we have to understand that they are really our ambassadors. And they are the people who can not only turn around the countries in which they work and the companies in which they work, but more importantly, if they come back to Pakistan, they can really transform the culture of organizations and the operations of the organizations and play a role in developing this country as well. So based on the research which I did, as I just mentioned earlier, there are some factors, and I mentioned two types of factors. One is personal and the other is professional. In terms of personal factors which expats are looking at, and this is again nothing new, but I'd like to address the 1% who may eventually follow. The security is a very important factor. Infrastructure, this is what the feedback is from expats who are coming back. I mean, this is what problems and issues they feel, and we have to address these if we want to attract them back. So it's security, infrastructure, importantly the education of children, because they are very concerned about their future as well. And we have seen in the recent past the inflation, social norms. There is a dichotomy of the way they work abroad and the cultures abroad and what they're used to. Some of these expats have spent more time abroad than in Pakistan, and then they come back and they have issues here. Corruption, we've been talking about this, and everybody right from Imran Khan down to the labor is talking about this. But what are we doing about this? And there's a great deal of recent harassment by different institutions in the name of corruption and otherwise. So there has to be a balance between economic development and corruption targeting. Mobility, most of these expats have worked abroad several times, like myself and other people here also. You must have visited, worked, and come back and gone back and forth. So mobility is key for us as well. On the economic side, we are very fearful of devaluation because we do want to save money, and in real terms, in real money, not in the devaluating rupee. Political instability, the less said, the better. Unstable policies which are causing a huge amount of uncertainty, not only in the corporate sector, but when a person plans his own life and future, this uncertainty also, you know, impacts. And last but not least is the failure of merit in nearly all aspects of our society. And this, I feel, is largely because of the degradation of our moral values. Now, this is a mirror. It's a list. What do we do about it? It depends on how do we think about it, how serious we think about it, and I'll talk about that a little bit later. Now, in terms of professional factors which influence expats when they're coming back, there are many factors. I've tried to put them together as part of this research output. And the factor which relate to the job, and these are nothing new. We are looking for expats who can match their competencies with local jobs, because there is a difference between the competencies required abroad and here. The knowledge, skills, and attitude and abilities required abroad and in Pakistan are quite different to some extent. Then we have to look at some employer-employee interfaces, new methods of recruitment, networking, getting to know each other. There has to be an improvement in the recruitment selection, performance management, rewards, career planning, succession planning practices, of which all of us in HR are familiar with. We have found that there's also a dearth of professional employers and even like-minded colleagues when you join an organization coming back from outside. And this is one area which we seem to neglect. Here we have a Pakistani who's come from abroad 5, 10, 20 years, and he is now being immersed in a culture which is very different. So how does he find like-minded colleagues to work with? And then not only local networks, but we've talked about this, and as I mentioned, work environment, facilities. And most people coming as expats are looking for organizations which have global links, and links which can help them understand the state of art in that industry across the world. And then obviously, one of the reasons why people come back is to be close to the family, parents, and so on. So all of these factors influence the job part of it. The other type of expats which come to Pakistan, back to Pakistan, are the entrepreneurs, you know. And they basically are looking at startup opportunities. They want access to capital, and they want a better understanding of the markets, brands, and the ability to design offers, the products, the price, the promotion, and all of that to suit local markets. And when they come back, they have to find the right team with the right mix of local and foreign talent, which is not easy to find. And then local partners as well. And what type of ventures? Is it a joint venture? Is it a royalty situation? Is it a marketing situation? What is it? And then they have to navigate through local laws, procedures, and very cumbersome approval processes. And all of this requires a huge amount of stamina and ability to withstand shocks, you know. So jobs, entrepreneurship, some of the expats which come back, they're looking for investment. Obviously, they have to have the capacity to understand and know and analyze the different options there and do their calculations of reward risk, because each has his own perspective, and then understanding local regulations and finding the matching local funds as well, even if they are bringing funds from abroad. Some come back because of the family. They have businesses in Pakistan, they're set by their forefathers and so on. But what do they face here is the generation gap. And even within the family, there is hierarchy and politics. And sometimes the business objectives or the cause which you mentioned may not exist with the family and may have changed by the younger generation coming back from abroad. So there has to be a congruence of cause in business as well. And also, very importantly, the difference in managerial styles between generations of businessmen in Pakistan. And that has to come across also. Then obviously some expats coming back, they come back for bigger and higher causes, social causes, national causes. They're not too concerned about investment or jobs or making money, but they are trying to link their personal and professional competencies with national causes, with some patriotic ambitions as well. So they have, in that situation too, they can't do it alone. So they have to find the right local partner or an NGO, and then what I call is create shared value for all parties and all stakeholders concerned, which is a very difficult task for expats coming back. Then again, there are managerial and operational issues. And then working in a cause is also trying to address the rising expectations curve, because if you help somebody today, the demand goes higher and higher over time. And eventually what you find is that it's very difficult to meet rising expectations, particularly when you're looking at social assistance. So these are the different types of factors which we feel that expats are facing, both on the personal level and as well as on the professional level. Now, what can we do about this? Well, first of all, there has to be a framework which will welcome these expats. And it's easier said than done, but it has to start from the top. And we have to put the money where the mouth is. And the first thing is by the government itself. There has to be a political will. And this political will is not verbosity. It's not those statements on the walls. It's not the speeches by political leaders. Ek Musliman ki pehchan uske amal se hoti hai. So it has to be physically demonstrated and visibly seen. So we want to see some real policies for these people. Then the other thing is using technology to link expats with the Pakistani situation. And we should use different types of web portals which can link employers with the prospective employees coming back. And, you know, we can... I've seen companies use these phones so admirably. They have an access to so many people abroad. And then use of innovative ways to search and attract Pakistani expats. A small example, I used to work for British Petroleum and we were looking for drilling engineers to work on remote drill sites in Upper Sindh and Balochistan. And we couldn't find people through the normal headhunters and advertisements and what have you. And one of my visits abroad to Canada, I was in Calgary, so I was there for about a month on a holiday. So on each Friday, I went to a mosque to say Juma prayers. And I asked the Maulvi Sahab at the end of the khutbah to announce that there is this guy, Saad Hussain, and you know, he's from such and such company, and if any Pakistani drilling engineers are willing to go back, they can contact him. And lo and behold, after the Juma, I was, you know, crowded by 35, 40 people, and they were all Pakistanis who wanted to go back, but they didn't know how to go about that. They said we'd sent applications and forms and what have you, but we didn't get the right response. So we've got to think of innovative ways of reaching out to them, like the Human Capital Forum is an excellent idea. Why not have web portals? Why not have e-platforms? Why not make it easy for them to apply? Why doesn't the industry in Pakistan work together and form a consortium to get and target these people and professionals? Why don't we hunt databases and, you know, LinkedIn and so on? My head of recruitment in Pakistan is not using traditional ways of recruitment. All she does is she goes on to web portals and these job sites and she gets the best people. And innovative ways, sorry, I can't talk too much about that. Then we've got to look at tax, financial, and fiscal incentives. Again, we've got to attract people in our national areas and the priorities that we want. And we've got to give incentives to these expats who bring the capital for that and link that to financial savings and so on. Also, the ability to remit savings abroad. If you can allow foreign companies to remit 100% of their dividends and profits and even principal back outside from Pakistan, why can't you allow expats also? They should have the freedom to do that. They're better than a company. They're their own people, man. And then specialized service centers, because these are people who can offer specific and special advice to expats coming back on different aspects of setting up a business, financing, hunting for people locally, and so on and so forth. And then, most importantly, banking and investment facilities. When they come back here, they're unfamiliar with banking facilities. They don't even know how to get a pay order made, what to talk about trying to put together a debt equity for a project and so on. Also, I strongly feel that in institutions such as these institutions and good institutions in Pakistan, there should be a quota. And this quota is to be on a merit quota. It's not like handing out a merit quota for expats' children when they come back. And then there should be professional forums such as these for networking and for entertainment, because they may be used to a different type of entertainment abroad, but when they do come back, they still do need some kind of entertainment, sports, and social activities. So they should have openings for clubs, and they will only enrich the population of the club by becoming a member there. Now, this is my last slide. It's basically talking about the young talent that we have. I feel that we have to actively recruit talent that is graduating from the top universities in the final year. We shouldn't wait for them to graduate and then approach them. And I'm talking from expat perspective, the universities abroad. And I said earlier, we have to set up a consortium across the business which targets Pakistanis from the leading universities and link them to various talent programs within Pakistan, like the internship programs, like the management trainee program, the trainee engineers program. In my organization, we have 138 trainees, out of which 50% are from foreign universities, and they come and work here. And they work for a year and a half or so. They complete the training program. Some stay back, some go return to the original, but it's a useful program. And then do something similar to the Fulbright program. For example, a business may help pay for an employee's education in return for X years of service. Again, you're targeting expats here. Or do something similar to the 2+2 program at Harvard, where you help employees apply for these programs which give you admission in a cohort that starts 2 years later. And in the meantime, the company invests in building their capacity so that when they come back after 2 years, they have a full-time job and a sustained career to pursue it. You know, one of the best universities in Canada is the Waterloo University, and they have a co-op program which is absolutely world-class, and that's a good example too. So I'm not talking about what do we do with the young talent when they are thinking of coming back or when they are coming back. I'm talking of an end-to-end solution. Is even before they are thinking of going abroad, create the thought and the purpose for going abroad is to get the knowledge and skills and then to try to convince them to come back to greener pastures back here home in Pakistan and not abroad. Because you are people of this soil and you want to die here, don't you? So that's the whole thing. That's my presentation. Now just one last statistic as to how India is now restructuring its expat program and designing its the younger generation. So in 1989-90, 7,000 Pakistani students were enrolled in the US, whereas from India there were 26,000. So there was a ratio of 1:4, and this is 1990. So just 10 years or 15 years after that, what do we find? We find that there are 132,000 Indians and only 5,300 Pakistanis. The ratio of 1:4 has gone up to 1:25. Now that is very serious. So we are still in the brain drain part of the equation. We are not in the brain gain part of the equation. The whole idea is to gain and gain through brain gain and not lose through brain drain. That's the whole idea. Now, this is my presentation. But this thought about repatriation, mujhe namaz ke baad khayal aaya ki bhai hame kyun itni fikr padi hui hai repatriation ki? Because Allah Taala ne aapko paida to kar diya kisi jagah, magar aap duniya mein kahin bhi ja sakte hain. Aur repatriation koi lazmi cheez nahi hai. Aap kahin bhi kaam kar sakte hain is duniya mein jahan pe aap apne deen ke liye aur apne liye اور اللہ کی خوشنودی کے لیے آپ کام کر سکتے ہیں اگر وہ ماحول مل رہا ہے تو وہیں رہیں یہاں نہیں مل رہا ہے تو نہ آئیں اور کہیں مل رہا ہے تو وہاں چلے جائیں آپ کی پیدائش آپ کے اوپر نہیں ہے مگر آپ کی زندگی آپ کے قابو میں ہے آپ کا دین آپ کے پاس ہے آپ اس پہ عمل کر سکتے ہیں سو ریپیٹریشن از ناٹ اے گیون فارمولا اللہ نے ساری دنیا انسانوں اور مسلمانوں کے لیے بنائی تھینک یو ویری مچ
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Okay, we'll take some questions here. So I'd like to start off with the first presentation, which was around the millennials. So my question to the panelists here is, sure, we have this new generation of millennials, and they're seeking a certain kind of an organization which is purpose-driven, mission-driven, and where the, you know, the values... where there is a larger purpose to the organization than other than just, you know, simply making money. But there aren't that many organizations like that. So where are these millennials going to find meaningful work and get all of them, you know, adjusted? So what's, any panelist, any one of you can take the answer, please.
I'll just... start. A couple of things. I think in my recent experiences, what I've experienced is that this is one of the reasons that remote work and entrepreneurship is on the rise. Freelance work is on the rise because they get into the job market. They realize that this is not what we are looking for or this is not what we wanted to do. And that's why they try to do something that is different or that is in line with what they wanted to do. And that's why freelance workers is on the rise, remote workers are on the rise. Lots of organizations are now starting to focus on this. But like I said, that we are much behind the curve as compared to the rest of the world. Reason for that is that, I mean, we're behind the curve in everything. But in most of the organizations, the amount of organizations that have come up in the past 10 years is very limited in Pakistan. So most of the organizations have been here for a long time, and that's why there's a complement going on over there. There's lots of previous workers who are there, who have been in the organization for a long period of time, and then the new workers are coming in, but it's a slow and gradual process. You will find very limited organizations that are there who are purely based on millennials and the upcoming organization, which has not even started contributing yet.
I remember, and I'm, you know, we are open to questions from the audience as well. I remember my time at Telenor, my back in the 2005, 6, 7, 8 time period. The average age that we had at Telenor was 28 years. So on average, around 3,000 people working there, average age 28. But our attrition was less than maybe, I don't know, 4%. People did not leave. So why is it that now people, when you showed that in your presentation, that you know they're jumping from one organization to the other? Why is that?
I think it's the generational difference. Those people at that point in time were 28, but they were not part of the millennial organization, millennial generation. They were the part of the generation before that. I mean, I was a part of that generation also. I mean, before the millennials, the seniors, and then the, you know, the generation before that. Their mentality is different from the people who are coming up now. So that's why at that point in time, the attrition was lower. Similarly, then there are other factors, factors like freelance work, which has come up in the past 5 years. It's very easy to do freelance work. Immigration, that's become a big channel, brain drain ho raha hai, people are moving. In my organization, almost 60% people, when they leave, they move abroad. 60% people. And the turnover is above 10%, so you can imagine how many people there are.
I think there are companies who, as a part of the package that they offer, some of these new startups or IT-based companies, foreign companies who are operating in Pakistan, as a part of their package, they offer that if you are selected in 2 years' time, we will give you immigration to a certain country. We'll move you to Germany, for instance. So I think that is something. Asasa, would you want have something to say?
Yeah. Is it on? Yeah. Okay. So I want to talk about something very, very simple, very, very basic. When we're talking about different generations, that is definitely something that we have to consider. And we have to also consider just basic human psychology. The fact is that the world is very different now in the last 20 years, in the last 10 years especially, and then in the last 20 years and so on. We have things on this device that did not exist 10 years earlier, that didn't exist 20 years earlier. And these, for example, Facebook, WhatsApp, Twitter, all of these have been designed very, very scientifically. These organizations, for example, Facebook, actually employ neuroscientists, people who actually hook up biometric feedback sensors to your body to see how you respond. They measure your endocrine response. Now, I'm telling you all this stuff not to give you some medical insight, but to tell you that they have scientifically figured out how to get engagement from their customers. Then they have figured out how to get engagement from their employees using research, using facts and figures. Now, the difficult fact is the rest of the world, like Anas showed, 87% disengagement is because the rest of the world is following folklore. That's just a fact. Okay. For example, one of the biggest is learning and development. Trainings upon trainings upon trainings. Think about this. You take the Pakistan cricket team and you put them in a room and say, okay, we're going to do a team building event. And you pass the balloon and things like that. What do you think is going to happen? They're going to laugh in your face. Right? Very obviously. They're thinking, yaar, hum log cricket khelte hain, ye kya kar rahe hain hamare saath? But yet we do these things in our organizations. To get human beings engaged, again, like Anna said, and because you're working in that environment, it's a very, very, tech is a very fast moving environment. So you don't have a lot of room to make mistakes. You need things to work right now, or you need things to work yesterday. Okay, So, for example, if you've got 87% disengagement in your organization, that's almost every single person not interested in working, okay? And one thing that's part of that statistic is 18 to 20% of them are actually sabotaging the workplace. They're actually destroying the workplace. To get people engaged, what we've been taught from like from when we were born till today is, okay, I'm going to tell you what to do. Biologically, these are research-based facts from Harvard, from Stanford, from Johns Hopkins, from Stanford Medical School, okay? Not my opinions. You have to ask somebody. This is the problem that we got to solve. Tell me how we're going to solve it. People start to think. People start to come up with answers. It's that simple. But think about it. Almost no one does it. And millennials, they've got a lot of choices, just like you were saying. They're like, you know what? No one's asking me for solutions over here. I'm going to find something, a problem to solve. And they'll jump, and they'll jump. Also, the problem is that they've been so accustomed, habituated, unki aadat ho gayi hai with to dopamine hits. Okay, anytime there's a ding ding on your phone, you're looking at the message, you're getting a little chemical, which is similar to cocaine. It's very addictive. Anyway, long answer to a short question. You need scientific engagement strategies.
Well said. And I just add to that that CLC, Corporate Leadership Council Research, they looked into this engagement and they identified 25 top factors which can increase employee engagement. And out of those 25, the top most factor is the to provide the answer what or why you are doing a certain job. You know, the answer to why am I doing this? How
Absolutely.
Is this adding
Absolutely.
Value? And I think this relates back to what Anas had said earlier, that it is about the purpose. It is about finding out where do I fit in this organization? What is my contribution? And that is a lot of, and that requires a lot of communication from the organization. I'll take any questions from the audience. Anyone? Please.
I think we're talking a lot about the tech sector, which is different. And some of the sectors I've worked in, petroleum, banking, large-scale manufacturing, which is ICI, very diverse businesses, they have some of the same issues, but they have certain different HR issues also. And if I take banking, for example, HBL, the company I worked for 12 years, almost 12 to 15,000 people. How do you fill that workforce? Now, we're talking a lot about millennials because, in a way, that is a very small elite population, the ones who are coming out of IoBM or LUMS or IBA. We need them because we need them as the leaders of the organization. We're talking about repatriation because, you know, with the demise of MNCs, where are the ideas going to come from? But you also need the bulk. And the problem with the bulk is, one, it's a different class of people. And I don't think that we're focusing very much on that class of people. And it's a different skill set. They're coming from universities that are not preparing them for the workforce. And we're just not, as employers, we're just not doing enough to prepare those children when they, and we need those children because we need the phone bankers and we need the retail banking officers and we need people in our branches and we need the sales force in pharma and we need people to run our machines. I mean, we can hire as many millennials or elite people as we want or bring people in from abroad, we still can't run our businesses without those people. So that is something that I want to throw out to the audience. Let's also talk about those young people, please.
A very good question. And yes.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This is Basil from HR Valley. I'm a freelancer, actually. I'm working from home since 2013. आप लोगों की बातें सुनने में बड़ा अच्छा लगा actually, and quite insightful information which you are giving. But in my opinion, मैं समझता हूँ कि जो organization का main challenge है वो purpose से हट के accountability का ज़्यादा है. We are really don't like to work. And we are not being nurtured to work. Or from academia system, I'm not talking about the lead management system, but majority, जो कि middle class and lower middle class sector है हमारा, ये mindset वहाँ prevail करता है. जब हमारा दिल नहीं चाहता काम करने को, तो हमारे पास जो है वो organization में जब intact होते हैं तो काम नहीं होता है वहाँ पर. तो ये जो मिलेनियल्स हैं, ये चैलेंज हमारा रहेगा बिकॉज वी आर फाइंडिंग अपॉर्चुनिटीज आउटसाइड अवर रीजन. सो एम्प्लॉय इंगेजमेंट की अगर हम करना चाहते हैं, आई एग्री विद सर दैट के हमें साइकोलॉजी और न्यूरो साइंस को पढ़ना पड़ेगा. हम लोग फैमिली से डिस्टर्ब हैं, पाकिस्तानी पॉलिटिक्स से डिस्टर्ब, इन्वायरमेंटल फैक्टर्स ने हमें बहुत ज़्यादा इम्पैक्ट किया हो. हमारी एजुकेशन जो है वो कॉम्प्रोमाइज्ड है, हमें वो पढ़ाने वाले लोग नहीं मिले हुए. तो चैलेंजेस इंडस्ट्री और कॉर्पोरेट्स को अगर टैलेंट के ऊपर काम करना है या करना चाहते हैं, तो आई थिंक दे शुड डेवलप अ लर्निंग एकेडमी विद इन देयर ऑर्गेनाइजेशन. दे विल हेल्प टू रिटेन द एम्प्लॉयज. दे डोंट नो हाउ टू वर्क द ऑर्गेनाइजेशन. दोज हु अंडरस्टैंड वर्क, दे कैन टीच देम हाउ टू वर्क इन द ऑर्गेनाइजेशन. दिस इज माई ओपिनियन इन दिस. Just sharing.
Thank you. So, आपका नाम क्या है? आपका सॉरी आपने नाम बताया था. वासिफ साहब. ओके. वासिफ रजा. ओके. सो वासिफ साहब, आई थिंक वेरी गुड. सॉरी बासित साहब. ओके. सो वेरी गुड पॉइंट. हमने एक सेशन अभी मुगल चैप्टर लाहौर में कराया. The scope was skill development. So usme Punjab Skill Development Fund sponsored that session. You know what was the summary? They said there's a gap of 1 trillion rupees that needs to be spent in capacity building in Pakistan to bring our workforce at par with the international standards. And they were mostly focusing on the blue collar. So Pakistan mein ek bahut bada dilemma ye raha hai ki 72 years we have not worked on the competency and skill set of the industry. सो हमने उधर उनको जो ऑफ़र किया वो ये दो चीज़ें थी. हमने कहा एक तो जो इंडस्ट्री की स्किल का अपग्रेडेशन है उसमें गवर्नमेंट का भी एक रोल है, एक प्राइवेट सेक्टर का भी रोल है. सो लेट्स मेक अ कंसोर्शियम. सो वी आइडेंटिफाई द इंटरनेशनल सर्टिफिकेशंस एंड स्किल सेट्स एंड देन सी हाउ यू फिल इन द गैप. सेकेंडली हमने कहा कि जो हायर एजुकेशन कमीशन है वो अपनी नेशनल अकेडमी ऑफ टीचर्स बना रहा है, विच इज़ कॉल्ड पाकिस्तान नेशनल अकेडमी ऑफ टीचर्स. उसमें जो 50% फैकल्टी आप लें उसमें हमारे और फॉरेंस भी आ जाएँ. You know, so I see Ijaz Nisar is sitting here, you know, welcome Ijaz. So a big organization which is working on the capability side, you know, management house. Then we have Hassan is here, Hassan Nazar. And you know, so many other friends. So basically, sare ikhatte ho jayen aur faculty recommend karein higher education commission ko. So these should not be only professors. With all respect to professors, 50% professors, but then 50% you know, from the corporate. Achha, ye trainers jaake kya karenge? Sabse pehle to faculty ko train karein. देखें आपने एक मल्टीप्लायर इफेक्ट क्रिएट करना है. आपके पास फॉर एग्जांपल 100,000 फैकल्टी मेंबर्स हैं. आज उनका माइंडसेट आई वुड से रिसर्च बेस्ड नहीं है, इंडस्ट्री बेस्ड भी नहीं है. यू नो, जब आप ये दोनों चीज़ों से फिल इन करेंगे डाटा एंड देन यू एक्चुअली प्लग इट इन यू नो विद द इंडस्ट्री एक्सपीरियंस, दैट्स वेयर द कमर्शलाइजेशन ऑफ रिसर्च कैन टेक प्लेस. दैट्स वेयर द कैपेबिलिटी कैन अपग्रेड इटसेल्फ. सो हमने ऑफर कर दिए. सो रिस्पॉन्स वॉज हायर एजुकेशन कमीशन के जो चेयरमैन थे उनका रिस्पॉन्स ये था कि हम कंसल्टेटिवली फैकल्टी रिकमेंड करें एंड वी सेड वी आर इवन विलिंग टू ऑफर दिस फ्री ऑफ कॉस्ट. सो जो फैकल्टी इंडस्ट्री से आ रही है वो पैसा नहीं बना रही. दे डोंट वॉन्ट टू मेक मनी बाय यू नो जस्ट स्पीकिंग एट वेरियस फॉरम्स. दे वुड बी वेरी हैप्पीली डूइंग इट बिकॉज दे वॉन्ट टू अपग्रेड द नेशनल कंपेरेटिवनेस लेवल जो आज है. सो वी ऑफर्ड इट. वी सेड वी विल अरेंज द सीईओज, वी विल अरेंज द पीपल फ्रॉम द रीजन, दे विल फ्लाई ऑन देयर ओन कॉस्ट. आप सिर्फ प्लेटफॉर्म अवेलेबल कर दें, ये ना करें कि सिर्फ एकेडीमिया ही एकेडीमिया को बढ़ा के चली जाए. उससे क्या होगा, लिमिटेड माइंडसेट अगेन, नो कनेक्शन विद द इंडस्ट्री एंड एंड ऑफ द डे जो बच्चा सीखे जाएगा वो फिर आउट ऑफ डेट हो जाता है. यू नो, तीन चार साल के बाद वो आउट ऑफ डेट हो चुका होता है. सो दैट वाज द चैलेंज एंड दैट इज हाउ वी डिड. नाउ दिस वाज वन डिस्कशन. वी वुड लाइक टू डू इट इन साउथ एज वेल.
यू नो हमने हैक को कहा है कि साउथ में आके इस प्लेटफॉर्म को ओपन करें. Karachi is the home to the corporate sector of Pakistan, and we respect that, and we want to have people in Karachi talk about it and help north as well, because Karachi se jo wisdom hai, it should flow north. North people should also come to south. That was the idea. So I think let's carry on with this discussion. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Any, yes.
Assalamu alaikum. Khizr here. I work for Coke in training and development. I've got this question from this panel of people, brilliant people, mashallah. I was going through this economic forum research, the 2030, 2050 top skills requirement. And number one was resilience, problem solving, and decision making, which was coming from not using these tabs and gadgets, by going outside and putting yourself into challenge. So my son is 7 years old and he hasn't been through any video game so far. He goes out, he plays cricket and football like crazy. And I'm just putting this question to you guys that am I doing the right thing? Because I want to get him exposed to this outside environment more than sitting inside. Thank you.
Let me take this. So when I was getting my degree in psychology from Berkeley, one of the things that happened just by accident was that the guy sitting next to me was an Olympic level swimmer. He also turned out to be what we call academic genius, okay? And in addition to that, it turned out he hardly ever studied. So everything that I know about being a genius is you study 24 hours a day and you wear glasses that are really thick and that's how you become a genius. So Vuchis, it stayed in my mind, but that took me on a mission to actually understand how he's doing what he's doing. When I asked him, he said, I don't know. And obviously he didn't know. Now, here are facts, biological facts, again, based in neurobiology. That's come out of the best institutions that I mentioned. When you become physically active, your brain lights up in a way that it does not in any other function. That's just a fact. Okay? Okay, second thing, solving problems. That is something that lights up your brain much, much more than if you sit and you read something without a purpose. Okay, so for example, if I was to say, ki bhai, this is a Lego box, it's yours, he's going to be like, okay, great, now how do I make that plane or car or whatever, theek hai? Then you give him a document to read and say, okay, once you've read this, you'll be able to make this plane. Trust me, he will retain it 90% of it the first time around. And once he's made that plane or car or whatever it is, the next step will be where he's going to get creative and he's going to be like, wow, that was fun. Ab isko teda meda karke, maybe I can make something else out of it. Here's the interesting thing. Companies that go from zero, like in Silicon Valley, from zero to $1 billion, to $10 billion, to $100 billion, to $1 trillion, they have institutionalized these things. It's not by accident. It's not by accident that Apple 20, 23, 4, 5 years ago was in red, minus, and then goes to $1 trillion. Google didn't exist. $1 trillion. Amazon didn't exist. $1 trillion. They institutionalize these things and many more. But this is one of the biggest things that they do. They make sure that you are not being told what to do. You are solving problems.
Let me extend this into the Pakistani corporate environment and what we can do in reality here. I think that the managerial style and approach to management in Pakistan has to change. What we read in the books, in MBA programs, and the theories and concepts are not necessarily applicable on the workplace in Pakistan. And I entirely agree that physical activity and mental activity go together. You can't separate them. If I don't play tennis after Fajr in the morning, I have a dead day at office. It's as simple as that. Now, organizations need to transform in Pakistan. We have the younger generation, whether they're millennials or otherwise, and we have elderly people like me also. And we have different approaches to life, we have different approaches to management. So what do we do in the organization? And our solution is that you have to have the right mix of both. And you have to give the right playing field to both segments. You cannot constrict them. You require the old and experienced experts because they have the knowledge, they have the history, they understand the organization's culture, they are rooted into that organization, some are founders even, and they will die for that cause. Longevity. You have the millennials, intellectual capital. They are the thinkers, the analytical people, different management styles. So we've got to look inwards also.
Anas, you want to say something?
Just wanted to add that two other things also which are important for organizations. Merit, we've talked about quite a lot. And I think going back to the gentleman from Coke, it's correct. Resilience, problem solving, those are important things. And that can be at any level. It can be at your grassroots level as well as your elite level. In fact, the people who are coming out of the smaller universities or more deprived backgrounds show a lot more resilience than people who come from elite privileged backgrounds, right? And the other thing is merit. So if you want to get ahead as an organization, you have to be able to recognize the merit and harness that merit, and whether it's through coaching or whether it's through offering opportunities overseas or whether it's through better training, you have to be able to harness that merit for your organization. And there again, I'll go back to my point that we need to look at our workforce holistically. We need to look at the institutions where they're coming from. They're not all coming from elite institutions. And as corporates, we tend to engage with the elite institutions, but we don't tend to engage with the other institutions. We need to go out there and engage with those institutions also and tell them what we need and how they should be shaping their students.
Thanks. Just a couple of things I'd like to add, because the panelists have covered it quite comprehensively. I guess a lot of parents will relate. I have a son, he's 5 years old. I don't think there's a best practice book when it comes to parenting. So I don't know whether somebody can say, am I doing the right thing or am I doing the wrong thing? I mean, it's for everyone, it's very, very different. But I do feel when it comes to relating to the topic of the new workforce. Look, 10 years ago, 15 years ago, it was the employer's market. Now it's the employee's market. This is a huge change, right? Before today, employees used to run after the companies and they wanted to be employed. And there were certain companies like Unilever and Shell and P&G. And if you got a job in those companies, it was a lifetime job, right? Your career is made and people retired over there. Today, the companies are running after these people and they want to get these people. And I'm not just talking about the elite institutions, I'm talking about these days, even from all universities, because the canvas of learning has widened. You can learn from anywhere. Do you know, in companies today, the restriction of having a bachelor's degree or a master's degree, that's going away. Pretty soon, you won't be required bachelor's degree or a master's degree. It started with the tech industry right now, but I can 100% guarantee it will spill over to other industries, because it's a reality. Children can learn from anywhere. They don't necessarily have to be a university. Certain skills are not even taught in universities that they can learn online. So I think it's the employees market now, and employers or owners of companies or co-founders, they need to understand this and change their approach accordingly.
Just to add on, it was a very, very healthy discussion that we had. And I think Anas raised a very, very valid question of millennials. I just want to add on, there is a recent study of Gallup which covers this topic very holistically. It's a global issue of multi-generational workforce and inclusion. And I think that encompasses the perspective given by all of you. And just for the audience, if somebody gets a chance to study it, or usme sabse bada challenge ye hai ki 56% I think people are unhappy with their managers, the real source of disengagement. And then it dwells further upon it and it goes deeper and deeper. I think all the points, whatever that you have made, holistically, it covers the entire. Thank you. That's the point.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Sara Tariq, and I've just recently returned back from DC. Everything that you spoke in your presentation spoke to me right away, so thank you for that. I have a couple of questions, actually a list of three. I'll start off with my first one. One of the things that I've noticed that when I moved abroad and I worked there for 2 years, when we received our job description there, when I received it there, it was very specific. I knew exactly what I had to do. I could plan accordingly. I could work accordingly. Before that, I'd worked in Lahore for a good 4.5 years. I was working as a project manager, but handling 40,000 other things also. Moving back here, I've taken a job in Karachi and I'm doing the exact same thing. So yes, I'm working as a grants manager, but you're also working on 4 other things. Something that I think we find frustrating when we move abroad is that, you know, how specific we end up working on things, and then we move back and then they give you a salary and a package of, let's say you're going to work on one thing, but then ask and demand of you to work on 5,000 other things, which can be very frustrating. So within organizations, I want to understand, like, how are we planning on changing that and making it more job specific, not that you don't learn a lot from it. Second thing is that another thing we learned was that the terminologies that we use a lot that are abroad, yes, the CEOs and the COOs are the same everywhere, but there are a lot of other managerial positions which are very different, and there's no synergy between those job descriptions or those tier level jobs within Pakistan and then the ones abroad. So it's confusing when you're sitting through an interview and trying to explain what you've been doing. It's like, I you know, you can't engage within that. So if we could also work on sort of creating the same kind of synergy levels within those jobs abroad as well. And my third, sorry, question is that if you've been working, for example, if in my case, I've been working in the development space for the past 5-6 years, but I want to now move to the corporate. In here, it's very difficult, I feel, in Pakistan, that if you do not have Engro or Nestle or Coke on your resume and you want to move to these companies, you'll be taken seriously because you've not. Even though within my development space, I worked as an organizational manager, I worked as a project manager, so my skill set, so-called, is there. But because I don't have those industry names, my CV will not move forward. So what advice do you guys have for that? Thank you.
Why is it me? But anyway, Sara, these are very, very useful questions. I think the Pakistani landscape in the corporate sector is changing so dramatically every day, and the scope of jobs and job descriptions are so volatile. In my organization, I ask the job holders to revise their job descriptions every quarter. And when I see that, I find that there is 20 to 30% change in their tasks and duties, responsibilities, KPIs, and so on. And I think this is the nature of the environment in which we are living in. It's very different from the established businesses and the slow, I wouldn't say slow moving, but institutionalized businesses abroad. We are very volatile. And we have to accommodate that volatility on the jobs and in our management structures. So it's inevitable it's going to happen. The advantage of this is that the world is moving towards a multi-crafted professional. The greater exposures you have, and what I call the greater breadth of specialization that you have, the greater opportunity you have within the organization and outside. So don't take it negatively, just keep on revising your job description and pestering your boss and the HR people to update it. With an updated job description, you should have a higher job size. And with a higher job size, you should have commensurate salary, if there's any professionalism in that organization. And you can very easily argue for that. It's not unheard. The second thing you mentioned is about titles. What makes a job is not the title, but it's the scope of the job, the responsibility, its accountability, and the competences required to perform on the job. And that's what determines the job sizes. So I think, as I said earlier, titles are going to disappear in the next 5 to 10 years. It's what you're doing that matters. But in Pakistani organizations, given our feudal culture and our background, titles do become important. And people have two titles, one within the organization, one outside the organization. So, I mean, this is another dichotomy that we have. But I think titles within the organization need to be made more innovative so that they indicate the type of the job, not the exact scope of the job. And when you're talking to a CEO, obviously, a CEO of Gulamdin and Company and a CEO of Unilever are different people, but still, you can understand that what and where they are coming from. Their scope may change, but the title depends on the organization also. So that's also something which we have to look at. Big company names, I think that trend is disappearing gradually now. We don't look for people who have worked in multinational companies. We don't want them, to be quite honest. I don't want the P&G and Unilevers of this world in my company. They are misfits, and for many reasons. They have got ambitions we can't deliver. They have got skill sets that we don't want. They have got a lifestyle which is contradictory to our culture sometimes. You know what I'm talking about? So you have to choose what you want to choose. And what I find in my experience is that a lot of the good Pakistani private sector companies, which are really growing much faster than the multinationals in Pakistan, they're looking for these people, not for multinationals. They're looking for people who have got ordinary experience but have done extraordinary work. And they are able to hunt for them. So don't give up. I'm telling you, there's a lot of potential here, and people who have got the intellectual capacity have got tremendous opportunity. It's an employee's market, right?
Yeah, just add on the last point only. And I agree that trend of working for multinationals, ek time tha, because it was a lifetime job, lifetime perks, everything. But now that trend is changing. I'm a personal example. I left Shell. Shell is the Fortune 500 will be top 5 mein aati hai. It doesn't get bigger than Shell. But I left it for a very small local company that aligned with my purpose. I knew I would be contributing a lot more. So don't go to don't aspire to be at a Unilever just for the sake of it to get the name on it. What if they give you a really, really bad job? But it's at Unilever. Would you still go for it? No, you would want to do something that you really want to do, right? And then the company name should not matter. You should be happy about what you want to do, if it's aligned with your purpose, if you're enjoying what you're doing, your job is what you love, that's what you have to go after, not the name.
Yeah, just to let you know, Shell incurred a loss of 1.1 billion rupees this year.
Thank you for that.
Okay.
Okay, so thank you all very much. We've been saving a special nugget for you for the end. And that comes in the shape of Mr. Asad Rizvi. One of the things that he did not mention in his introduction was that he has actually worked with a gentleman by the name of Anthony Robbins. And we as a team thought that it would be a good idea to have a glimpse of that at the end of this session. So now that we are closing to the end of this session, I would request Mr. Asad Rizvi very quickly, if you could, we would request you to compress it because I think people would need to go. Give us something that reminds us of Anthony Robbins.
All right, so I have to, I am going to very quickly, like Anas already mentioned this study, Tige. Let me tell you the significance of this number. In 2011, I was contacted by the Abu Dhabi Board of Directors and Sheikh Nayan, and they wanted me to lead the turnaround of Watin Telecom, Tige. Now, to give you a visual idea of what this means, imagine a ship hai, theek hai? Uske upar jitna crew hai, wo baitha hua hai, cigarette, paan, chhaliyan wagaira, aur ships mein niche suraakh hue mein, aur ship doob rahi hai, theek hai? Aur Abu Dhabi Board of Directors put me on that ship and they said, ki, you gotta turn this around. What do you do? How do you save a sinking ship that is actually, you can see before your eyes, the ship is actually sinking, there's holes, or log uske upar baithe hain, doing nothing. And kabhi kabhar uske andar ek do hole aur bana dete hain. So I had no clue. Very, very honestly, I had no clue what to do. So I went on this mission to actually figure out. Now, I have a degree in psychology. I understand human behavior. I've worked with Anthony Robbins. Anthony Robbins is the world's best, okay, doesn't get better than that. But this was, in my opinion, sort of like dealing with a mini Pakistan, okay? We had a workforce of 2,500 people. Jiske andar se, I think there were several hundred that were just conchas. It was a very, very difficult project. So I went on a mission, I mean, that was a story in itself, but I went on a mission to actually understand how to get results really, really fast, okay? So I read, I think in the first month, I must have read, gone through like 50 books, gone through McKinsey, Bain, kitne documents, all of that stuff. Then I, you know, I sat down and I said, okay, there's somewhere in the world that people are getting very, very fast results. And that was the Silicon Valley. They go from zero to $1 trillion in a very short span of time. So what are they doing? So I found out they're actually using, like I already shared, research-based strategies, TK. Now, if you look at most companies around the world, this is what happens, okay? Businesses are commoditized. You look at most businesses in Pakistan or worldwide, commoditized businesses, ka matlab kya hai? Ke they are fighting over small margins. 85% of the employees are disengaged, theek hai? And that's why there's a huge trust deficit. Trust deficit ko jisko bolte hain, bureaucracy. Ya, you know, another name is silos and all that. And then there's low morale. People are not working. On average, according to Gallup, people work 2 hours a day. That's it. 2 hours a day. That doesn't mean that in those 2 hours you're getting genius level work. It just means that they're doing what they're supposed to be doing. Okay? There's extreme low morale, and then there's a vicious downward spiral. Rumor mongering, leg pulling. All of that stuff that we take for granted, not just in our companies, but also in our nation, okay? And therefore, snail's pace target achievement. Okay? I'm not telling you anything new, but the thing is this, we're used to this stuff. We've taken this model, okay, but this is how it happens. This is business as usual. But there are companies, I mean, look at Apple. How did Apple do it? How did Apple become a trillion-dollar company? Apple doesn't have these problems. None of them. So how did they do it? Okay, so you want to create exponential growth. How? These are the companies that have already done it, and there's a lot more companies. Okay, aapko pata Hilton, Hilton Hotels, it's a 100-year-old company. The company market capitalization is $20 billion. There's another company that you know very well, owns no hotels, only 10 years old, is now worth $32 billion. It's called Airbnb. How did they do it? So, very simply, this is how it works. They've got one core focus, okay? Then they stack synergies. That unleashes employee creativity. I mean, it's like explosive creativity. Then rapid growth, and that means they actually encourage failure. Do you know why? I'll tell you why. Because until you are going for those crazy solutions, you're not going to come up with something interesting. What does the rest of the world do? They punish failure. That's what we've been taught our whole life. Punish failure. Okay? This is what they use in companies where they are doing extraordinary things. This is what they use in companies where people are engaged. This is where they use in families, in countries where things work. Okay? The competition is irrelevant. You got to figure out what your gift is as an organization, as a human being, as a country. That's when you come up with the billion-dollar ideas, okay? These things have become, you know, disruption. It's a very popular term these days. Take it, disrupt, disrupt, disrupt. But there's something that comes before disruption. It's called having the right mindset. You got to stop looking at what the competition is doing, and you got to start looking at what the world needs from you. Let me give you a secret. Pakistan made the biggest opportunity. Okay, and this we actually monetized in Watin Telecom. Because Watin Telecom was another commodity business. Literally, paison ke peeche hum log bhag rahe the. Theek hai? Aur ma fiber ko jo tha, uske to hum log loss pe karte the. Thought ye tha ki jab hamara fiber network sabse bada ho jayega, phir hum log paise charge karenge. Wo kabhi bhi nahi hua. Theek hai? Magar Pakistan mein aapko pata hai sabse bada problem kya hai? Everyone's scared. Hum sabko dar laga bhai, kal kya hoega? Uncertainty. And you know, that if organizations and if people start to actually give certainty and start to monetize it, they will start to thrive. We actually did that at Watin Telecom in 3.5 years. I just did that at Aga Khan Hospital. That's another commodity business, okay? Second thing we do is create extremely engaged team. Again, very, very simply, instead of telling people, this is what you have to do, we tell them, this is what the problem is. How are we going to solve this? Chand se jaake ek chand ka tukda humko khench ke leke aana hai. Batayen, how are we going to do this? The first response, people, is, that's it. And then we encourage people, batayen, 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 kaise? Then people start to come up with solutions, okay? When those insane, crazy solutions come, that's when you come up with the wicked solutions that solve impossible problems. And all of this stuff that I'm telling you is stuff that we actually did Watin. That's how we got Watin from losing $2 million per month. $2 million per month losing to $1 million positive cash flow. In less than 3.5 years. And not just that, we dropped the workforce from 2,500 to 1,300. Jab ye hota hai na, downsizing. The culture, the morale, the trust is completely lost. We did exactly the opposite. People were on fire. And not just that, do you know that in the history of Lahore, one of the biggest fires was the burning down of the head office of Watin Telecom? So we had some massive challenges. But yet, we made magic happen, and this is how we did it. Okay? And then flawless execution. So instead of doing twice a year annual reviews, which by the way, research has proven to that actually drops performance, we did it weekly. Think about it. If you want to lose weight, and if you're going to measure your progress once or twice a year, do you think you will achieve your target? No, you won't. If you're measuring it once a month, yes, more likely. If you're measuring it once a week, you're probably going to hit your target. We institutionalized Friday afternoon. Teams have got to sit together, samosa mangwai, falsa mangwai, juice mangwai, pizza mangwai, jobi. But you sit together, you create friendship, you create relationships, you make, you figure out how much progress you've made over the week. And you course correct. And we institutionalized this thing. People started doing it, okay? And then we created an engineered environment. But I really, really took this to another level. Now again, you might think I'm a genius, I probably am. But the thing is that, you know, all this stuff I learned by actually studying research, TK. In Aachen, we created a six-tier engineered environment, which included a Facebook page, which included a three-person communication team that their only job was to go around taking photographs and making videos of people actually executing, people actually getting results. There was no hierarchy. One of the most extraordinary execution plans came from four floor nurses. जब आप हॉस्पिटल जाते हैं ना जो नर्सेज होती हैं जो आपको नजर आती हैं घूम रही होती हैं कमरों में इधर उधर. Four of those nurses got together, created a game-changing execution plan, which was featured internationally in a medical symposium. This thing, creativity and engagement, can happen from anywhere in the organization. And then that is what leads to rapid-fire, insane progress. Now, I've done this with many organizations, TK. The two biggest ones were Watin and Aachen. TK, Aachen was my last one. I worked with the Pakistan cricket team, TK, and the reason why I'm showing you Pakistan cricket team, in 2016, if you remember, they went on this crazy winning spree. So I worked with them just before this. I used the exact same strategies with them. So this is not something that is limited to an organization. The same thing. I'm talking about human psychology. I'm talking about human neurobiology. And this is what they use in companies in Silicon Valley. And of course, now they're using it in China. They're using it in a lot of companies. Atlassian in Australia, okay? Doing incredible, crazy things. These guys went on a winning spree. Why? Same thing. I asked them how to solve the problems. I got them engaged. TK? You can't give them training. Ye log sadak se uthke aaye hain. Ye log, I mean, sorry to say, ke wohi gali galonch wali zuban istemal karte hain ek dusre ke saath. Gora unka coach wahan pe side pe baitha hua hai. Usko wo jo bilkul hi street level galiyan hoti na, those were the nicknames for their coaches. How do you make these people perform at that peak level? How do you make them believe in something? You give them a vision, then you ask them how to solve the problem, and they use the exact same stack. You stack the synergies. That's how they went on that winning spree. Unfortunately, it didn't last. I wasn't there, and PCB asked me, but I actually declined because PCB has a whole bunch of problems, which I'm sure everyone in this room knows. TK? I just want to show you this thing, TK, and I'm not showing you this to actually impress you, but I'm showing you this, ke the quality of results that we got at Aachen in less than 1 year were spectacular, TK. Now, I was, jaise aapne kaha tha, I was the team coach. I didn't play the game, TK. He said all of this stuff because the team played so well. And this gentleman, Hans, okay, he does not suffer fools. Maine jab ye project shuru kiya tha, he met me just for 15 minutes and he gave me an ultimatum. Asad, I'm going to give you 1 month. If you get results, you stay. If not, bye-bye. That's it. Koi lambi chodi baat cheet nahi hui thi. 15 minutes, meeting was over. Okay? This guy was really excited. I don't know if you've heard of Sohail Tubani. He's a very senior physician at Aachen. He came up to me and he said, Asad, in 35 years or 33 years that I've been at Aachen, I've never seen any CEO being so excited. Okay? Again, same strategies. Now, I'm telling you, ek telecom tha, ek hospital tha. Different industries, completely different mindsets. And hospital is a difficult environment. Huge egos, not easy. Theek hai? And that's what Hans told me. He said, Asad, I've been in this field for many years all over the world.
it does not work. I said, okay, fine. We'll try it. It worked, okay? I was written up in Newsweek magazine, again, only because it was such a spectacular success. This is actually a video. So Anthony Robbins, who's been my mentor, been my teacher, I worked with him for about 15 years. He found out what we did at Aga Khan. And he actually filmed this 1 minute video where he's actually talking to the nurses in Aga Khan. He's saying, hi Asad, how are you? I want to talk to the Aga Khan nurses. You guys are doing an amazing job, working very hard, and to the doctors and to everyone. And you know, then he acknowledges me and he says, you know, I just want to say my good friend Asad, so on and so forth. Now he's never done this. You go on YouTube and you try to search an endorsement by Anthony Robbins. He does not endorse products, he does not endorse people, he does not endorse companies. The only reason he did this is because he saw in a place like Pakistan, niche se engagement upar aa rahi hai.
Hello everyone at Aga Khan Hospital University, it's Tony Robbins. Listen, I just wanted to take a minute to reach out and congratulate you on the incredible work you're doing there at the SL4 Hospital. My dear friend Asad told me about your passions and he also just told me about the level of absolute care that to a man and to a woman you have, especially the nurses that are, you know, facing with those patients and figuring out how to take care of them. I just take my hat off to all of you and I just want you to know that your work is making the difference. I know you're in the trenches every single day and you know, there are ups and downs in the process of what you're doing, but I hope in your soul you take in the difference that you're making for people's lives. And I just want to send my congratulations and my love and my thanks for all the beautiful work you're doing. I hope I get to meet some of you someday. And a big hello to my dear friend Asad. I love you, brother. And thank you for the work that you're doing with this group. I know this project means the world to all of you. Let's just take it to fruition and have the most impact humanly possible. Blessings to you all.
The reason why I'm sharing all this with you is to emphasize, okay, the old was based on folklore. Our school systems were not designed to educate, they were designed to school. It's a big difference. TK? The companies, most companies around the world are using folklore. They're not using facts, figures, research. Companies that are getting massive, incredible results in the world, they're using research. They're using science. That's how they get engagement. That's how they get employees that come in and start to produce incredible work. Now, ye main aapko bata raha hoon, but that's one thing. Now, let me give you a very simple example, okay? Imagine we're sitting in a plane, theek hai? ऐसे ही होता है ना आयल होती है बीच में यहाँ पे सीटें होती हैं यहाँ पे सीटें होती हैं इमेजिन द प्लेन इज अबाउट टू टेक ऑफ तो क्या होता है टेक ऑफ से पहले आपको एक सेफ्टी ब्रीफिंग मिलती है राइट सो इमेजिन आई एम द क्रू एंड आई कम अप कि भाई दिस इज योर सीट बेल्ट एंड ये आप सीट बेल्ट लगाएं आपकी सेफ्टी इंस्ट्रक्शंस रखे हुए हैं उसको प्लीज़ पढ़ लें और ऐसे करें और वैसे करें ऊपर से ऑक्सीजन मास्क निकलेगा और उसमें ये होएगा पहले अपने ऊपर लगाएं फिर अपने बच्चे के ऊपर लगाएं वगैरह 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 we've all heard that probably about 10,500 times. Anyone remember? Does anyone remember? Does anyone, can anyone remember word for word? I mean, if you have heard something 1,000 times, chances are you would remember it. Why is it that no one remembers? Now, imagine, probably aise kabhi bhi nahi hoega, theek hai? Imagine, aap plane mein baithe hain aur wohi safety briefing wala insaan aaya hai aapke samne, aapko bolta hai, ladies and gentlemen, the plane is about to crash. I'm going to show you how to save your life. Please pay attention. How many of you will be paying attention? Exactly. That's the difference between 87% disengagement versus 100% engagement. To get engagement, you have to tell people what the outcome is. You have to tell people what the big picture is. You have to tell people what the vision is. And not just wo jo hota hai na, like you said, one of those fancy things that you put on the wall. Oh, the purpose of our company is to look good and look pretty and sound great and do nothing. No, it's not one of those things.
Everyone knows every company has those things, and everyone also knows they are completely meaningless. No one believes in them. A vision is what Steve Jobs gave. We do things differently. We're innovative. We find solutions. And it was not just that. It was that when people came into the organization, that's what was demanded of them. So, वहाँ पे they've institutionalized these things. You know that at Google, there is a policy. One day of the week, any one day, you can work on anything that you believe will really work, company related. Fail or succeed is not the point. That's why Google owns the data in the world, okay? So engagement is the breakthrough idea that we all need to keep in mind. Thank you.
So ladies and gentlemen, I would like to thank the panelists on behalf of PHCF who have come here and shared their knowledge and their expertise, and I wish we had more time. I have a lot of questions still that I wanted to ask and discuss, but thank you. Let's give a big round of applause. As we close down this session, as you all know that we have been for this particular event, we have been hosted by IoBM, and I would like to now invite Mr. Talib Kareem to please join us on the stage. Aye, sir, please. And I'm very, very much thankful on behalf of PHCF for IoBM to host us for our first launch for the Mehran chapter in Karachi. And if you could say a few words about this event.
First of all, I'm very thankful to the forum for selecting IoBM. I think it's very important for the universities to engage with industry. I think for past many years, that did not happen. I think now we see a change in that trend where universities are now working with industry, because I personally feel that if there's a disconnect between the academia and the industry, then it's totally unfair to our students. I think what we have done at the master's level is to change our curriculum to be more experiential type of curriculum, where now our students are required a 6-credit-hour capstone project. They have to work on a capstone project within industry. So a team of 5 students along with a mentor, a faculty member, will go to an industry, get some sort of a problem from that industry, and work on that and try to resolve and come up with recommendations. An interesting thing about this project is at the end of the day, they are the assessment is done by the industry, not by the faculty. So it shows the quality of the project that they have worked on and the type of solution they are coming up with. I think 2 or 3 points that were raised and how what we are doing as a university is, I think a point was raised to produce entrepreneurs through the university platform, and we are doing that. If you are into some exercise, then I will request you to take the staircase while you go for snacks downstairs to the basement, and stop on the 3rd floor of this building. This is a brand new building, although I'm opposed to having such interaction within a studio, because we do have training halls and others, but I think the concept was that engage our students in terms of recording. These are all our students, our media students who are doing all the recording, and those who are sitting behind and that glass room. And you'll see that floor, the I think it's the 2nd floor, We have a very nice training hall that is, we have not inaugurated it yet, but it's furnished. And on one side would be our incubation center, where we'll have our students coming in, to that center, coming with ideas, and we'll try to support them, just like what an incubation center should do. And then we have ORIC, which is an essential part of a university, with its Office of Research, Innovation, and Commercialization. And on one side is our training and executive. Also, I would request you to walk down and take a look at that center. And I will also request you to be part of that, that incubation center if you have an interest towards developing entrepreneurs. Because I think someone mentioned over here that faculty, you know, a PhD in certain area, they are very theoretical. So you cannot really engage all PhDs, and I always tend to argue with HEC in that, that how come you're opposed to practitioners coming in as faculty members, and their mindset is, no, it should all be PhDs, and you know, especially for MBAs, I think we need practitioners. And I think at IOBM, we do have, of course, about 160 full-time faculty members, but we also have about 150 practitioners who are teaching here, and two of them are sitting here. Shah Saab has been teaching for many years at IBM. Naved Khan Saab is sitting there teaching for many years, and there are many other examples of bankers and you know, marketeers and those who are here as faculty members. So I would like to engage with the forum. I think as an institute, we should work together. I think bring in such, I think I was just noticing while I was sitting with Dr. Samra back there, is that I don't see our students or faculty members in this hall, which is unfortunate. I think they should have been here. I think students are busy with their final exams, so I think that's why they are not here. But I think a few of our faculty members should have been here, because I think this was a great learning type of interaction. And I hope that you know, we work together on various. We'll be more than happy to host you whenever you are in Karachi, because I feel that you know, these type of forums can benefit our students, our faculty members, and us. We are ready to work for you in terms of research. If you want to engage our faculty members, our students, and interestingly, all this is free of cost, because the reason is that it's a value addition to us if we develop local case studies, or if we you know, work on these areas, whether it's related to HR or whether it's related to other areas. So I hope you know, in future we'll be working together. And thank you for being here. It's a Saturday, just 2 days before Ramzan, and a very, very hot Saturday. And I was a bit pessimistic since yesterday that not too many people will come, but I see quite a few of you are here. So thank you for being here, and we hope to see you again over here. Thank you very much.
Okay, so just as one last thing, there is a customary practice that we have, that we give a token of appreciation to all our panelists, and our tradition is that we, since we are a knowledge sharing platform, so we focus on giving books, because these are the treasure chests for. So what we'll do is we'll invite some of our advisory council members as well to honor them and their presence here in this forum.
Yes, yeah, so.
To start with Talib Saab, so if you can present this to Asad Bibi Saab.
And
Let's have a smile for the camera. Nishad, you can join us here. Picture. Thank you. So I'll request Shakil Mabara to join us. Shakil is the part of the advisory council of PHCF. So it's a small souvenir from IBM as well. Shakil Saab, thank you for coming. So we will now request Shah Saad Saab to receive our memento from Shakil Saab and Talib Saab. Shakil Saab would present the memento to Shah Saad Saab. Shah Saab, thank you for your presentation. It was wonderful. So these books are on talent, organization development. And I was looking at one book, it was written by Nushad as well. So well done, Nushad. Okay, so a smile for the camera. Thank you. Thank you, Shakil. I'll request Ijaz Nisar to join me on the stage. Ijaz is here, he's the CEO of CEO Club. So the only club that have gathered the entire galaxy of CEOs in Pakistan. Ijaz, welcome to PHCF Mehran chapter. Ijaz is going to present a book to Madam. So we have a small book on employee experience. And there is a plaque from the university here. Yeah. Thank you, Nausheen. Thank you for your contribution. And then our last but not least, the great Anas Ahmed, who has given us a wonderful presentation today as well. Anas, thank you for your time, for your efforts. And the plaque from the university. Yeah, okay. There is a plaque for our moderator, Nushad Saab. So I'll request Talib Saab can present the plaque to the moderator and the chapter lead, Mr. Nushad. In the end, we would also like to present a book that is actually written by Nushad, and it's on organization development. And I'll request, Talib Saab, thank you very much for all your support. And this book would remind you, you know, of the forum and the efforts. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Talib Saab. So I would like to particularly appreciate my core team, obviously led by Nushad, but we have wonderful team members who have made this happen. Aapko sabko emails aayi hongi. So those emails were written by Almas. Almas, can you please join us here? Almas Ali is a wonderful contributor to the PHC of Mehran. Not now, since the last 5 years. So our Mehran chapter ke jo first core team thi, usme bhi Almas played a great role. So was Aman. So Aman Khairati saab, please join us. Aman is a member of the core team again for the last 5 years in PHCF. Is working with Karachi Electric right now. Ye energize kar dete hain jahan bhi jate hain. To forum ko bhi energize kar rahe hain, mashallah KE ko bhi kar rahe hain. We have Kamran Bilgrami saab. He's member of the core team as well. So Kamran has done a great job in showcasing the PHCF cause, you know, and that's where the industry academia come in. I think the academia industry linkages cannot happen without your support, and I'm very glad that you have spared your team resources for PHCF. We also have other core members of the team. So Shakil Mabara Saab is also a member of Mehran because he's been a great support for Karachi. Mabara Saab, please join us again. There are 118 advisory council members of the forum, which are around 80 CEOs and chairmen of the group, and there are some 30 from the region, so including Shakil Mapara, and all the advisory council are advising us how to expand globally and on the strategic matters only. So this is the team. We are expanding the team further, so we would request anyone of you would like to join the core team are more than welcome. We have another core team member sitting here who is a witness to whatever we have done in Pakistan and abroad. And his name is Javed. So Javed, please join us here. Javed Iqbal is CEO of TransformX and is a digital transformation expert. But humne inko request ki thi ki hamari digital policy ko thoda sa develop karein, and especially for social media. Abdullah Khan se bhi main request karunga hame join kare. Abdullah Khan is head of brands of PIA. So Abdullah Khan is, aur PIA aapko pata social media ko bada actively manage karta hai, to aap inki expertise ko hum utilize karenge for PHCF Mehran chapter. Let's see that you can join us, Abdullah, here. I'll also request Khizr from Coca-Cola South, and Amin Saab is here. Amin Saab, please join us here. So this forms the core team of PHCF Mughal Chapter. As I said, hamare hats hote hain. So ek hat hamara events ka hota hai, ek hat hamara social media ka hota hai, ek hat memberships ka hota hai, ek hat mentoring ka hota hai, ek hat youth connect ka hota hai. So these are the five hats. But under the hats, there are certain team members. So usually the core team size is 10 to 15. Brilliant, dynamic volunteers who are willing to spare their time for the forum. So that's how the forum operates in each city.